Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Say, look.
All right. Good evening, folks. If we can come to order, please. This is the October 19th, 2020, 7 p.m. meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I'm Chair Amy Scott Gailey. With us tonight, we have Vice Chair Steve Carter. We have Commissioner Bill Lashley, Commissioner Eddie Boswell, and Commissioner Tim Sutton. So, Commissioner Lashley, would you please lead us in an invocation and the pledge?
I'll be glad to. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening to praise you and lift your name up above all names. We ask you to guide our lives, bless our nation, bless us, bless everyone here tonight, and we ask you to give us wisdom to make the decisions that's honoring to you and to the people of Alamance County. These things we pray in your holy name. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, the first item of business is the public speakers. So we have one person who has signed up to speak on an agenda-related item. I'm going to come back to this when we talk about approving the agenda. If you look at the business items, you'll see that we do not have on here currently listed separately an item related to the Alamance Aggregates rock quarry in Snow Camp. But it is, I think, anticipated to at least be discussed in the closed session as an update for that lawsuit. So with that in mind, we have Stephanie Thurman who wanted to be heard about the rock quarry. So we're calling her, right?
Yes. Uh-huh.
So if you want to, Madam Clerk, if you want to go ahead and call Stephanie Thurman, that would be great. Okay.
Hello, this is Stephanie.
Hey, Ms. Thurman, you're connected to the county commissioners meeting.
Okay, awesome. Can y'all hear me okay?
We can, Ms. Thurman. This is Amy Gailey. You can start your public comment whenever you're ready.
Okay, can y'all hear me okay?
Yes.
We can, thank
okay,
you.
Okay, sounds good. Okay, I'll get started. Hold on one second. Let me just cut my phone off. Okay. My name is Stephanie Thurman, and I live in Snow Camp. I spoke to you at the last meeting about my concern regarding a contingency plan for supplying water to our community, but during the commissioner response time, you never addressed my question. Mr. Boswell, at the Board of Commissioners meeting on June 3rd, 2019, you stated that people's water is very important. And where will the county be able to stand if these wells, meaning the wells in Snow Camp, are contaminated? Are we in the position to run water out there to these folks? As I shared with you 2 weeks ago, Colonial Pipeline recently leaked over 275,000 gallons of gasoline in Huntersville, North Carolina. On September the 25th, the NCDEQ issued a notice of violation to Colonial for contaminating the community's groundwater. As part of the remediation, Colonial is paying to have area residents connected to a municipal water supply. As you very well know, Colonial's gasoline pipeline and two additional lines carrying jet fuel and diesel run right through Snow Camp and the proposed mining property. Colonial has stated in three separate letters to the state that the blasting operations could represent a threat to the integrity of their pipeline. Alamance County does not currently provide a municipal water supply to the unincorporated community of Snow Camp. That being the case, we would like to know, what is your contingency plan for restoring water to the 6,000 residents of Snow Camp in the event that a permitted industrial activity leads to a disaster like what happened in Huntersville? In summary, again, I would like to know what a water supply contingency plan would look like for Snow Camp and what would be an estimated cost of that plan. And just in case you're wondering, I did pose this same question to the land planning board, but we can't wait for them to reply to this. An undetected leak in the Colonial Pipeline, like the one in Huntersville, could occur at any time in Snow Camp. We need to know now so that we can adequately plan for our sustainability. Can you please appoint someone or a committee to look into this for us? Thank you for your time and assistance. That's it. Thank you.
May I ask her a question? What's the policy on this?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah. Do you have copies of those letters you're referring to about the pipeline?
Oh, yes. I'm sure we can get copies of those if you would like to see them.
Do you have them, Klein?
No, I do not.
I don't understand the conflict there. Yes, I'd like to get you to provide us copies of those letters, if you would.
Okay, you're talking about the letters that Colonial Pipeline sent to the state?
Yes.
Okay.
I think
okay.
You said there were three letters?
That's doable.
Yes, I'd like to see them, and if you'll provide them to our county manager, I'd appreciate it.
Okay, I will do that.
Thank
no
you.
Problem. Thank you. Should I hang up now? Do you have any more questions?
It looks like you can hang up if you...
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, the commissioner responses to that are kind of wrapped up with the question about the agenda. As I mentioned, we don't have currently a thing or an item on the agenda talking about the rock quarry and open session or an update about the state action. I think that at the last commissioner's board meeting, that was definitely expressed that we wanted that, and the county manager and I discussed that at our agenda meeting, but it for whatever reason is not on the agenda. So is that the desire of the board to add that as an item of business?
I would like to see that added so we can talk to our planning director and kind of see what your take on this.
If that's a motion, I'll second it.
Okay, let's we have a motion and a second to amend the agenda to add the Snow Camp Rock Quarry. Let's see, who should we add it to? We have people here for the earlier things. We have the evidentiary hearing for Cranmore Meadows. And
can we just put it right after that, since Tanya's speaking, I guess, for that?
Yeah, that's a good idea. Let's add the discussion about the rock quarry between items 2 and 3. And we'll talk about it then, so it's more formally addressed and more appropriate than sort of batting around with commissioner responses. So we have a motion and a second to amend the agenda. Is there any more discussion about that? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? So the agenda is amended. If there's it's a motion to approve the agenda as amended.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the agenda as amended. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Great. The next item up is the consent agenda.
Approve. I'll make a motion. We approve the consent.
Mr. Lashley has made a motion to approve the consent agenda. Mr. Boswell has seconded it. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Great. The first item for business is a public hearing for the Community Development Block Grant. And we have Corey Roberts I think, is here from the Piedmont Triad Regional Council, and Tanya Cattle are going to present about that before we entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
Wonderful. Thank you for having me. On behalf of Piedmont Triad Regional Council, we welcome this opportunity, and we're happy that we're in a partnership together with Alamance County to present this. So we'll go over the PowerPoint that I have presented here, and then we can have any questions answered after that. So a little bit of the overview of the grant itself. It was administered through the North Carolina Commerce Rural Economic Development Division, as awarded through North Carolina, and we have the ability as a county to apply for this grant. PTRC cannot apply for this grant as a standalone. So the state was awarded $27.5 million to disperse throughout the state, and each award can be up to $900,000. So roughly figured about 30 awards across the whole state, so a very limited amount. And this is a first-come, first-served grant, so we're hoping to be one of the first ones on the block to get this. We know that there are about 12 others that are ready to apply for it right now, so we're trying to be up there in the top. So this is for low and moderate income families and households. So the areas of focus that we're looking at is support families and communities through telehealth support and other public services through medical and special population needs. Protect the most vulnerable and high-risk populations, assist small businesses with economic recovery, and address testing, tracing, and trends. So what we're looking at in our application packet is to hit three of the four of those. We are not looking at the assist small businesses with economic recovery in this application. Public services, this is a list of all the public services that you can go for with the grant. The only one that we're not touching is the food distribution of this list. So as you see, we're looking at a lot of different aspects of this grant application to hit as much as we can to get as much money as we possibly can coming into Alamance County to help the residents of Alamance County. So the details of this, this grant is a direct assistance and area-wide. There's two different aspects that we're looking at. The direct assistance touches on rental payment assistance, utility payment assistance, child and daycare assistance. And then the area-wide aspect of it, we're looking at the mobile testing and tracing and trends of vaccination clinics, wireless mobile hotspots, and medical reserve corps training. So these are the areas that we're looking at in the green areas for a low and moderate income. Those are the areas that hit above 51% low and moderate income when you look at the HUD exchange rates. Knowing that Burlington is outside of that area because they get their own assistance, they are excluded. So we're looking at the other areas in Alamance County to assist with this. So these are a block groups, and these are a total of block groups that meet the 51% or higher. So if you look at those, you have several block grants that really exceed the 51%. So those are the areas that we really want to focus on getting this assistance to make sure that we're not evicting people, to make sure that they're able to afford the housing, utilities, and then child care so that they can go back to work, and that's the ultimate goal. So as we've laid this out, again, $900,000 sounds like a lot of money, but it's really not when you start dividing all of it out. So taking out the mobile clinic and the healthcare piece of this, for the utility assistance, rental assistance, and daycare, this is kind of how it falls out. If we take $300,000 total for rental assistance, and we're saying that the average family rent $750 a month, times 3 months is $2,250 for those 3 months of assistance, we can help 134 families or residents. Utility assistance, we're looking at $200,000 total. Break that out to about $600 for each award over 3 month period. That's 334 families that we're helping stay in their homes and have power and water. Child care, daycare assistance, we're looking at $110,000 overall, plus or minus $800 a month, which we know child care is expensive, right? So we're looking at 150 plus or minus folks that we can help with that to make sure that they're able to go to work, they're not having to worry about their family, and that everybody's safe and secure. So the medical trailer that we're looking at, it can provide medical care on site, and we can pull this to those low and moderate income areas, and we prevent them having to come to the health department, having to travel, having to find transportation, all of that kind of stuff. So this trailer is a self-contained trailer. It can be pulled out to site, set up. It's got an onboard generator. It's got two medical clinics inside of it, two medical rooms. The back of the trailer there has a ramp on it, so anyone that's ADA can get up and into the trailer, so we can provide that kind of medical screening, the tracing, and all of that. Knowing that with COVID-19, you're going to have to do your testing outside. There'll be awnings on both sides of that trailer, and this will be the hub for our health department staff to be able to get in out of the weather or to get their supplies and that kind of thing and have them on site. So this has also got a bathroom shower combo inside, so we've got facilities for our healthcare workers, so we know that they're protected and they're safe, and they have a place that they know's clean and can get out of the way. So this trailer here can be pulled with emergency management trucks for the county, and they've already agreed to be part of partnerships with this. So if you'll see in your budget line item that there was some money there for that, that's what that is for. That's an in-kind match. There's no cash out of the budget. This is an in-kind match. They've already got the truck. They've already got the people. This is just kind of their support. And if you look in the budget, there's $5,000 for parking allowance. That's also just for, that's an in-kind match. They've got the area. We're saying that they're helping out, and that's how much it is. And those figures came from FEMA, the FEMA schedule. So this is the budget layout here, and the right-hand side kind of spells out each one of those. So the award for administration cannot be any more than 10%, so $90,000 of a $900,000 grant goes to administration cost, and that's pre-work and post-work reporting and all of that. So we've laid that out. Mobile medical clinic, in-kind support, transportation. Again, $175,000 is what we've allocated for the trailer, self-contained, ready to go. And then the $11,500 is for the tow vehicle and personnel to get it to site. We're looking at maybe this trailer going out and setting up for a week at a time. So it's going to be on site for a long time. It's not going to be a pull it out, have to pull it back in. It's also going to have a hotspot on it so that if the community needs internet access, they can go to this trailer and have internet access. $25,000 there for medical training and supplies and equipment. We know consumables are going to be used off of this trailer, so that's to kind of stock it up, get it ready to go. Once it's stocked up, ready to go, the usage off of it's going to be very minimal, but it's going to be the same thing the health department uses already, so it's not going to be any extra expense. Medical training for the Medical Reserve Corps. We've got a great bunch of folks in the county that already have medical training. They may just need a refresher. Maybe they want to do something as a volunteer. This will allow them to come in, get the training they need to be able to help the health department out and give us extra staff and respond to those needs. The parking area, again, as I said, they've already got the space. They're just saying that they're going to help and provide that kind of space. And then rental utility and child care assistance, which brings the total to $900,000 plus our in-kind match, which would be a total of $916,500. Now, with this grant, it's not saying that we have to do an in-kind match because there's no in-kind match needed, but we're saying that we're offering this up as a good faith effort, saying that we're going to support this program. So that is the presentation, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have on that.
Could we get our health director to comment on your opinion of this?
So we got to meet with Corey and his staff with several of our health department employees, so Jana, our logistics chief, our operations and things like that through our incident command, and talk about how this trailer can be used for not only COVID response, so we could use it for testing in the community, be able to take it out to several different areas of the county that we typically can't serve. We also can use it for COVID vaccination, and so that's kind of where we're at as the health department at this point, is trying to plan for that and be able to think about how to bring that to the community and how to best help those out in the community, especially in rural areas. And so with Alamance having so many rural areas, this will allow us to do that and go in multiple spots that we wouldn't necessarily be able to use. Having the access to the trailer will also lead to being able to do flu shot clinics around the county, using it for preparedness for other things in the future. And so there's lots of big plans that could go along with having this trailer and having the availability to us through this grant.
Just want to make sure you endorsed it.
Yeah, thank you.
Corey, where would these, where would you locate? I mean, because of security. I mean, this looks like a high-tech piece of equipment. You're going to set it in the county somewhere.
So we work with community partners to make sure that it's in a secure location, that it's not going to be out and about and open to everything. There's not going to be any drugs or anything that's maintained on it. But there will be refrigeration units on it so that when the health department comes out, they can bring their vaccines and stuff out and keep them climate controlled. As we know right now, that some of the vaccines for COVID-19 are going to have to be sub-zero temperature kept. So we're really concerned about that. And this trailer will give us access to keep that there on site while we're doing everything for inoculations.
And you would leave it there for a week or so at a time? Is that what you're thinking?
Yeah, the trailer would be there as long as it's needed. There would be a plan put together about how many people we're going to serve a day and how long it would need to be in that community.
It's a great idea.
I think it's a great idea also.
Okay, thank you.
Would it be stored with our other emergency management equipment over there?
Yes, it would. We have a secure location fenced where we store all of EM's equipment now. So the plan would be to locate it there and they'll help make sure it stays serviced if it's not being used. Right now, EM goes a couple times a week, cranks everything, makes sure everything runs and is in good working order and is ready. And yeah, I'm sure it would be added to their task list.
Would it tie up our truck to, you know, once you set it on site, does it tie up the vehicle to be with it?
I don't believe the vehicle would have to stay. No. And it sounds like the plan would be to take it to a vaccination site, leave it for at least a week. And then, you know, so the truck would be able to be available if it needed to pull generators or anything else.
Yeah, so there's a generator on the trailer so that it would be self-contained. Once it's pulled on site and set up, then it's there and nothing has to stay with it. It would be locked up and there would be a lock on the hitch and the trailer tires and things like that, so it couldn't be just picked up and moved.
Let's hope not.
Okay. That's important.
Exactly.
Now, this is an odd question, but I'm known for those. I suppose, how's it going to be painted or labeled on the side? I mean, some people might feel like if it's from somewhere else other than local, they might not trust it. But if it says Alamance County, Davidson County, or whatever, they might feel more trustworthy of it. How will the trailer be labeled?
That's going to be up to the health department. That's not in part of the scope that I've put together. So
I would imagine it would be something that would indicate it was an Alamance County asset. And that promoted I think the major use of this will be health department use. Mm-hmm. So Alamance County Health Department in some fashion emblazoned on it so people know that's county government, that's our local public health department in the communities.
Yeah, people might feel better about mm-hmm. it if it's said.
Most emergency management's got a lot of experience with that, but most of these pieces of equipment are labeled as the county asset and that can be well done with this trailer. So.
We have the item on the agenda is for a public hearing, and then after the public hearing, we also have the opportunity to ask more questions and have more discussion and entertain any motions that anybody would care to make. So at this time, would anybody be wanting to make a motion to open a public hearing?
Corey, can I ask one more question? Just come to me. What happens to this? A year, 2 year down the road, where does this go?
So once it's purchased, it's an Alamance County piece of equipment, so it's yours. So it's once it's done, it's done, and it's an asset of the county.
Access to having a mobile hotspot will be valuable.
Absolutely.
Yes.
I'll make the motion that we start the public hearing.
Second.
Okay, Mr. Lashley has made a motion. We open a public hearing, and Commissioner Carter has seconded it. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? So I think we had one person who had signed up in advance to be heard on this grant, and that was Lisa Moranis. And is she in the overflow room? She had been marked on the sign-up sheet as a callback, but then I think I was told before the meeting that she's actually here.
I
So you're Lisa Marinas?
I'm Lisa Marinas.
Marinas, I apologize.
No problem.
You have 5 minutes because it's a public hearing.
I will not take 5 minutes.
So you can start whenever you're ready.
Thank you for having me. In the opening blessing, you ask God to guide you with the wisdom to make decisions that are best for all of Alamance County. Maybe some background. Last Friday night, I was doing some leisurely research in preparation to cast my ballot when I came across this public hearing notice concerning the Community Development Block Grant. My mind was blown for all the amazing and exciting information, and thank you for bringing these amazing multifaceted resources to Alamance County. These are the kind of targeted solutions that make real change that we really need to help the 41% of our county. Now, I'm sure the 41% of our county that these resources are intended for, their mailbox are flooded with information that floods, that serves the interest of elected representatives. But where was the information for the people that need it to get it concerning this? That is my question. Like, no, I asked lots of low-income people and no one, like, where was the community that need this information? They don't have the information. We have amazing things going on in this county, but the people that need it don't have it. That's all I have to say. And thank you for all you do.
Thank you.
Great, thank you. That was a very good question.
thank you.
Do we have, Madam Clerk, do we have anybody else sign up in advance?
No.
Nobody to call? No. And so since this is a public hearing, I'm gonna address this side of the room and ask to my left, your right, is there anybody who wants to be heard on this grant? Seeing no one, I'm gonna turn to this side of the room, my right, your left. Is there anybody on this side of the room that wants to be heard on this during this public hearing on this grant? So no one has indicated they want to be heard. Would anybody
I'll make a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
He's motioning for somebody.
Oh, of course. I'm sorry. Before we
if there's
vote.
No one in the other room that wants to talk.
I forgot about the overflow. Mm-hmm. Apologize.
No.
Okay, so we have a motion by Commissioner Boswell and a second by Commissioner Lashley to close the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, so the next item is to discuss and entertain motions on the application. First, we'd like to ask, I guess, Tanya Cattle or Mr. Roberts, how do the people who need this grant, how are they going to find out about it?
Good question to ask.
Wonderful, thank you. That is a wonderful question and one we know about. So there are already housing rental assistance programs out there. So once that this grant has been approved by the state and we know that we've got the award, then we'll set up mass notification systems, television, radio, newspapers, and get the word out. We also do community-wide flyers to get the word out to them. So the marketing plan for this has not been established yet, but there will be a marketing plan established once the award is, because you know it's kind of hard to do a marketing plan before the award is.
Yeah, you got
to
get the award before that.
Right, you got to get the money before you can start advertising. You got it. That's right.
Anything.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And I'm sure our health department would assist with this by their contact list or whatever in the nonprofit world and all that.
DSS would also be involved in that. So.
Is there a liability scenario here for insurance or malpractice or anything like that that would be covered?
So I know we insure all the EM equipment. All of our equipment is insured for like property insurance. We also carry liability and risk to a certain level. So I think that would be the case. And then as far as like the medical actions taken, I think health has some levels of protection too for the nurses and doctors that are providing right. Any kind of medical care. So I think we would be covered.
But it's on our...
It would be on us,
yes. Yeah, it's ours once this is approved and it comes to the county.
Once we become owner of the piece of equipment, the trailer, or any sort of stuff, it becomes ours to insure. And then if health's using it for a mass vaccination, then the health staff that are out working that event would be protected under the county's insurance for the health staff, too.
And there is a match from the county of $16,500. Is that right?
It is.
In kind.
All in kind, yes.
But
in kind.
We already have that match with, from what I understood.
That's correct. I think, as Corey mentioned, our trucks, our staff moving the equipment, the county providing the space to park the trailer has all been valued per FEMA.
Per FEMA, yes.
And it came up to $16,500.
I will make a motion that we approve this.
Okay, if you hold on to that.
Okay.
The maybe amend your motion or make it in a form. In the agenda packet, we have a resolution for the County of Alamance application for the Community Development Block Grant funding for the CDBG-CV project. So if your motion was maybe to approve that resolution as presented.
I would like to approve the resolution for this grant.
Great.
Second.
Okay. Commissioner Boswell has made a motion to approve the resolution of the application for the Community Development Block Grant as presented in the agenda packet, and Commissioner Carter has seconded that. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Now, another item or another action under this item is that there is a residential anti-displacement and relocation assistance plan, which is part of the process. Maybe can somebody explain what that is? I'm told that.
So we're not commissioners, we're not planning to do any work to residences with this grant. It's all about the trailer, medical training, and then assistance for
basically COVID-19 related.
That's right. Yeah. So my understanding is that this is part of doing a community development block grant. In the event we were working on homes, we would have to agree to, if we got into working on somebody's home and it was found to be in a certain condition, we have to work to relocate people. That is not our plan with this project. So I believe this is we understand this to be a part of the process to apply for this grant, even though we are not planning to do any work on buildings. So
we would be possibly seeking a motion to approve the residential anti-displacement and relocation assistance plan as presented in the agenda packet?
Yes.
Need a motion? So moved.
Second.
Commissioner Lashley has made a motion to approve that plan, and Commissioner Carter has seconded it. Is there any discussion or questions about that? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you so much. Okay. Here we go. We have an evidentiary hearing, a quasi-judicial evidentiary hearing regarding Cranmore Meadows Manufactured Home Park. Hold on a minute. Don't start talking yet.
I'm not.
This is so that the public understands, this is not something that, evidentiary hearings are not something that this board has done a lot of. And since almost 4 years since I was sworn in, this will be my first one. Yeah. I don't know about you fellows who have served longer than me.
Not.
So the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm going to announce and call the case that this is the quasi-judicial evidentiary hearing regarding Cranmore Meadows Manufactured Home Park. Each person, wait, there's a... So as chair of the Alamance County Commissioners, I would like to explain the procedures used for this hearing. All those wishing to speak are asked to sign the roster at the podium if you have not done so. And that, I think, includes staff and just anyone who speaks. Whether you're staff, whether you're part of the people seeking.
Applicants.
The applicants, thank you. Or a member of the public who wants to be heard on the issue. This hearing will be considered quasi-judicial. The process is similar to a court proceeding. First, a staff member of the planning department will present an overview of the case. Then the applicant will have an opportunity to speak on behalf of the application. Anyone else present to speak on behalf or against the proposed waiver will be allowed to speak. The applicant may then be given the opportunity to present any rebuttal. Board members are asked to refrain from questions until each speaker has completed his or her presentation. All testimony is given under oath. Each witness will be sworn before he or she testifies. The proceedings of this board will be governed by the manufactured home park ordinance as recorded. All witnesses should come forward to the podium and identify themselves each time they approach the podium or speak after being recognized by the chair. Before each application, the chair will read the findings that must be made to approve an application, and any testimony should be relevant to the criteria that the board uses to determine whether to approve an application. Testimony should consist of facts each witness knows, not hearsay. Any additional written evidence or exhibits must be presented to the chair, and a determination will be made whether it should be accepted. Written evidence or exhibits will be made available for inspection to those present and will be made part of the written record of the meeting. All staff reports and materials submitted at the meeting will be made part of the permanent record with any additions, deletions, and/or corrections that may be necessary. All comments are recorded. If you wish to ask further questions, you may be recognized by the chair before speaking. I would also like to remind everyone in attendance to be courteous and ask questions respectfully. If there are, so I'm not sure that we've got numerous people who are wanting to give testimony, but if there are a lot of people who want to provide same or similar testimony, then we would request that you select a representative to present your testimony. I would like to note that board members may have visited each site under consideration as part of their preparation for this meeting. The board will vote on the case after the presentation of all the evidence and discussion among themselves concerning the case. So we're going to have people testify. People are going to come to the podium, sign their name, get sworn in, testify, and then we'll have another person come, be sworn in, sign their name, be sworn in, and testify. And then after all the testimony is taken, then we will have discussion concerning the case. Motions should either recommend approval of the review request or denial of the review request. Conclusions must be made for both approvals and denials. So I think that Tanya Cattle is going to give us an understanding about the issues involved. So as she presents the issues involved, after other witnesses testify, we should be listening for facts and evidence that support or do not support what the applicant is requesting. So before we proceed, does anyone on the board have any questions about the posture of the case or what the substance of what we're doing, the framework? Okay. So you were here to testify. And what is your name?
Tanya Cattle, Planning Director for Alamance County.
And Madam Clerk, would you please swear in
to the other PowerPoint?
Ms. Cattle.
The Bible is right there underneath. And if you'll place your left hand on the Bible and raise your right, do you swear or affirm that the testimony you shall give to the commission shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do. Put that away for later. Okay, what y'all have up on the screen right now is the kind of master site plan
There is some more detailed site plan pages that we can look at, but this shows you coming off of NC54, which is on the far right side of the screen. You've got a driveway coming in, and you'll see that there's a couple things up front of an event center and a home. Those things are not what we're looking at tonight. What we're looking at tonight is the manufactured home ordinance. In the manufactured home ordinance, the definition of a manufactured home includes a camper, a tiny home, or actual mobile home that comes in. So for this project, tiny homes is what's being proposed. And so you'll see there's 13 lots there, and that is some in the front. There's what, 7 up front and 8 in the back. And so you'll see the main drive going back. That is by definition in the ordinance travelway, so they had to make that meet certain guidelines as well with the ordinance. And the turnarounds in the first section and second section have to meet fire marshal's code. So that's already been reviewed. Those are good. You also have septic system and well, which is for the entire community. They're not by lot. That has met and has gone through preliminary review and environmental health as well. So those are good. What we are coming down to tonight, you'll find in the staff report, and I want to see, I think, what my map got off to. Okay. So you'll see on the map that you all have the largest acreage, and you'll see on the far east and southeast side of the property there is floodplain there. This is part of why the septic tanks and wells and things were placed where they were, because they have to meet guidelines.
Hold up.
Yes, ma'am.
Can we have that in our materials?
Yeah, it's that one.
Oh, it's on the computer. It's not.
Do you want mine, Amy? Oh, there you go.
This is it. Yes. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so on that, you'll see where the floodplain is, and you'll see an existing pond on the front portion or front parcel of the land as well. That was something that is part of the land that has been worked around. You'll see that in the staff write-up, I'll read it too for the record. Following, you will find the staff report for Cranmore Meadows, pin 158803 and 158796, manufactured home park review presented to the planning board on July 9th, the application attached at the end of the report, which you all have that as well. Development name is Cranmore Meadows. Location is at 3147 NC54, and that's Hall River. This manufactured home park. Tract size is 3.47 and 2.33 acres for the two pieces. There is no watershed on this property, but there is the floodplain. Just for record purposes, the school district is Alexander Wilson, Hallfields Middle and Southern High School. The applicant is requesting consideration for review of lot standards for road frontage requirements of 100 foot along a road. Currently, lots 1 through 7 range from 55 to 167 foot. Lots 8 through 13 range from 25 to 63 foot. This is part of the review they're asking for. The required setback of 45 feet from the center line of the travelway cannot be met by all proposed lots as well. This review would be site plan specific to this submittal. Space frontage. Each designated manufactured home space shall have a minimum width of 100 feet along the road travelway. Manufactured home spaces fronting on cul-de-sac shall have a minimum of 35 feet. Setbacks. The following setbacks are established for units within manufactured home parks. Side setback of 10 foot. The rear setback is 10 foot. And the front setback, it's a little odd, but 45 feet from the center line of the travelway. Effective setback is 25 foot if you pulled it off the edge of the travelway. In all cases, each boundary shall be clearly identified with corner markers. As you can see these lots very clearly on how they were drawn. These are lots that are for lease or rent only. These can never be transferred as individual lots like a subdivision. It is one big park, and that's how it would be bought or sold if it ever were to be, not by individual lot. The Board of Commissioners may authorize individual reviews of the application of this ordinance where there are practical difficulties or particular hardships in the way of carrying out the strict letter of the provisions of this ordinance. Upon finding practical difficulties or unnecessary hardships existing with a strict application, individual requirements may be modified provided they are consistent with the spirit, purpose, and intent of the ordinance. Substantial justice and public health and welfare secured. All requests for review shall be written to the Alamance County Planning Department. Prior to consideration of a review by the Board of Commissioners, the request shall be referred to the Alamance County Board, Planning Board for Planning Board's recommendation. That recommendation did come through as a unanimous approval. Hardship on this property definitely consists of the floodplain that pushed
some of the environmental concerns pushed their septic tank, which also changed their lot layout, and of course the actual pond, which the pond, you can see how the road kind of slopes around the pond. Couldn't go straight, you had to go around to make that road fit in there coming off the frontage. And that you can see the thin gray lines behind everything. Those are the contours on the land. So you can see how the land rolls well side to side and front to back. So that creates a little bit of a hardship just by the contouring of the land. Overall, the intent of this project is to have the tiny homes and to meet the manufactured home park ordinance. The general idea is met. The majority of the requirements in the ordinance are met through the lot size and through the emergency services being able to get in, service the public welfare of the general public in the area. Just in case, especially for the public, when you look at this area, zoom out a little bit from this actual parcel, two parcels over on the north, head north on 54, on the left and right sides of the roads, there are mobile home parks mm-hmm. existing, have been there, as Mr. Carr and I spoke, for some time. So this is not unlike the surrounding area at all. These are just modifications that are needed because of the type of land that we're working with here. And we do have some broken down. You can see the front half of the property, and you can see they've met our parking requirements, they've met the lot sizes, they've met the travel way, they've done the needed things to keep people's units apart and to keep the public safety more in hand. And then this is the rear part of the property, and it does show an individual home that is allowed by ordinance that you can do that. So we show the rest of the lodge, and you can see the Y turnaround, which would meet emergency services needs should they need to get some type of apparatus back there. This is not served by any kind of water and sewer per se, like city, so there won't be fire hydrants back there. This would have to be served by water trucks and things, and that was considered when the road was evaluated. At this point, I'll take whatever questions.
I don't think we're allowed to ask you.
You're not allowed to ask me yet. Okay.
Madam Chair.
No question.
I would suggest the witness ask the board to accept all exhibits that she's just presented and put them in the record.
If you all could accept exhibits and put them in the record, please.
Yes.
Thank you.
Give me
They're electronic. That's okay.
We can make that mm-hmm. part of the record.
Oh, okay. The electronic.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Those will be part of it.
It's all in your agenda packet, yeah. So that would be what I request to be on record.
Thank you for that nudge, County Attorney. So we will mark the PowerPoint presentation as Planning Director Exhibit 1. And that will be made part of the record.
Good enough. Thank you.
Great. Okay, thank you. Hang on a second, let me make a note. Okay. Next, we have representatives from Cranmore Meadows who wish to be heard. Okay.
Can we all come up, or do we have to do one by one?
Let's do.
You want to swear all three of them in? Say some time?
We could. Why don't you all three stand up?
Stand
the Bible. And put your left hand on the Bible and raise your right.
Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you shall give to the commission shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? So help you God.
Yes.
Okay. The first of you who wants to come up?
We'll take it right here. Well, thanks to Tanya and the commissioners for hearing us tonight. I appreciate your time. My name is Nathan. This is my wife, Callie.
Hey, Nathan, and you've got to give us your last name, too.
I'm sorry. Thank you. It's new to me, too. I'm Nathan Heuning.
Nathan, how do you spell that?
It's H-U-E-N-I-N-G, Heuning.
Okay, and what's your address?
3147 NC54, Tall River.
Okay, go ahead. You may testify.
Thank you. So, should I use this too? Is this how this works? Or?
That's the PowerPoint. Yes.
Oh, okay, great. Let me just check and see. Is that going to go? Okay, great. Yeah. So, how many of y'all have seen those little tiny houses on TV? Do you know what I'm talking about? The little microhomes?
Yeah. So we want HGTV.
Yeah. We'd like to do a neighborhood of those. That's the background context. And so the closest thing that meets is the manufactured home ordinance. And so we've been working really hard with Tanya and planning and inspections and environmental health to try and find something that works for this land. A little background. The reason why we're interested, we moved to Alamance County about a year ago. I work in Durham. My wife works for the University of North Carolina. We got married in Saxbahaw, fell in love with Alamance. We thought we'd love to make a home here. And so we've been here a little bit. We live in a tiny house on wheels ourselves for about 4 years, and we love it. And they're pretty popular, so we think there's a lot of demand for this, but the main challenge is, where do you put them? And you could put them in an RV park, but those are more intended for sort of transients, you know, part-time. We were envisioning more of like a full-time residential community where you could raise a family and this kind of thing. And so we purchased that lot, and we've been engaged Bobby Tucker as a consulting engineer. So he's also in Alamance County, right? Or you're in?
Just over in the chat.
Oh, just over in the chat. I'm sorry. Okay, well, close, very close. And we've been working with him to help us figure out how we can create a low impact community. And he's going to speak a little bit in a moment as well with some of his professional background as far as what we're trying to accomplish. But so you all know about this. There's plenty of shows on TV. There's a lot of interest and demand. And we thought that Alamance County would be a really terrific place to try and pioneer a model like this, because there's not a lot that we know of. And when we started building our house 5 years ago or so, all of our friends and family, they love the idea. They want to build one. Their friend wants to build one. But the people that we know that live in them, it's really hard to find a place to put them, legally anyway, because you can sort of put it in your backyard and don't tell anybody kind of thing. But we wanted to have a fully legal, beautiful community that you could park and live there and have raise a family. And we like these because they're much lower impact than traditional manufactured homes. They're much smaller. They're easy to move if you need to, that kind of thing. And so we're big fans of these. So Cranmore Meadows, as Tanya mentioned, is a full-time residential community. We can fit up to 13 is the most based on the septic requirements. And the land is beautiful, but very challenging. There's no flat ground anywhere. And so we've had to really work through those constraints. And our plan is to also have like some shared community space where people can come together or host events or things like that. We don't know of any like this in the Piedmont at all. So there's one in Asheville that we know of that's on a 50-acre lot that's already sold out through phase two, and they're ready to go. And so as far as Triad or Triangle, we don't know any like this. So we're excited to sort of be on the forefront of this. And the land itself, as Tanya mentioned, it's just off 54. It's by the Honda plant at 119 and 54, if you're familiar with that. It's about half wooded, half open meadow, and we're trying our best to also maintain some of the characteristics of the land. Bobby's been consulting with us on how to make sure that we're taking good care of it. And really, the land is not suitable for anything else except maybe grazing. That's why there's no kind of subdivision or houses on it already, because you can't really build anything. But this would be a good use, we think, of the land to create some of that. And we've been working with the NC Wildlife Commission to try and create sort of like a nature preserve as well for part of it. And then, so as Tanya mentioned, so there's substantial floodplain. There's some really steep slopes that have been very challenging. Bobby's going to speak more about this in just a moment. Actually, Bobby, would you like to come up and
well, you're testifying.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So if your testimony is finished,
oh, okay,
then you would sit down and he would come up and testify.
Okay, thank you for that. Yeah. So let me just finish real quick, and then we'll have Bobby come up and talk about this. Thank you. So he'll talk about that in just a minute, and this slide as well. And I'll just conclude with we think it's a fun idea. And so we invite you to consider, it's attractive housing, it's affordable housing, it's the units hold their value, sometimes they increase in value as well, which is nice. We're thinking that there's a lot of young professionals that we know that might want to come to Alamance, and that can increase the workforce skill set and improve the tax base as well. And because they're so small, the infrastructure that you need to service them is much lower than a traditional subdivision, and so we're pleased with that. With that, I will conclude and turn it over.
Okay.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, y'all.
Good evening.
My name is Bobby Tucker, and as you know, I'm the client's engineer for this project. We're going to talk a little bit about the constraints on the
Mr.
land.
Mr. Tucker, could you tell us your address, please?
Yeah, I'm 1300 Silk Hope Liberty Road. So as they mentioned, you know, this is, I guess, the natural constraints of the property, which lends itself to being good for their goals of eco and agritourism and bringing people out there and having events and having sort of a quaint, quiet community. Is also was challenging for, you know, meeting certain ordinances and requirements, but we did the best we could. As you saw on that site plan, it is bordered half the property by a pretty major creek. It's also a jurisdictional floodplain that covers pretty much most of the flat open ground, and that transitions rather quickly into steep terrain that's wooded. And the contours don't really represent it all too well, but it's rather eroded land. There's a lot of draws and all that. It would take quite a bit of mass grading and clearing to really make things to build out by any kind of conventional means. And then there's obviously existing water features in addition to this large creek, existing pond, femoral channels, and you know, some wetlands on some of the bottom land. And the soils are, you know, they're lucky enough to get enough suitable soils to do conventional drain fields on both of their main sort of buildable areas, but they've sort of maxed that out. And that was broken up into several spots to sort of make it work. And you can kind of see how the homes were sort of, which is what one of the reason the setbacks were reduced for the first seven lots was partly to not be on the drain fields. So we were able to work with as much of the existing kind of farm row that was there to sort of grade that out. We invested in a topographic survey to really optimize the cut fill without doing mass disturbance on the property. So we did extensive surveying along that road corridor and were able to meet the fire safety requirements to get a 20-foot travel lane. So there's not going to be any safety concerns for the homes. And we were able to sort of squeeze things in to meet the 8,000 minimum square foot requirement for having a community septic and a community well that's serving all the homes. And we're getting, you know, both parking spaces for each lot is tucked in there, and have met the minimum road frontage requirement for, I think it was like three of the first seven lots at least. And just speaking to that too, I mean, that 100-foot is really set up for the manufactured, you know, mobile home, and what they're doing is something that's considerably smaller, and it's a lot more mobile sort of to pull in and out of these designated parking pads more or less. So it's part of the manufactured home ordinance, but I guess it's somewhat irrelevant when it comes to this particular building structure. So like Tanya had mentioned, I mean, it's really the 45-foot setback, even though you've got like 10 foot on the sides and 10 foot on the rear, they've got this 45 foot that we were not able to meet for the first seven. And that's really primarily just staying off the drain fields. And then the 100 foot, like I said, was met for three. And, you know, I think the overall goal here was just, as, you know, objective engineer, was, you know, not to have something that really, you know, destroyed the land, was an impairment to the natural water body, really upset the neighbors by doing mass clearing. You know, some of the property owners on the, well, really on both sides, but particularly on the north side, are, I mean, their homes are within that minimum requirement. So if they were to grade up and met those requirements, they'd be clearing trees almost to that, and that's you know, not a way to come in and make friends with folks. So yeah, and then at the same time not sort of drive cost up to where their vision and their goals here, which I support and I think is unique, becomes cost prohibitive. So I think we've done everything we could to meet the requirements that we could, but there's just a few that we're asking for you know, forgiveness on, I guess. I think that.
Wait, can you go back to that for a second,
ma'am. Please?
Just taking notes.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Did you want to testify?
He covered my slides because I thought we were both going to be up there. Yeah. So,
okay. All right. Is there any more testimony from Cranmore Meadows, the applicants? If not, then we will accept the PowerPoint that you have used in your presentation. We will mark that as applicant exhibit number one, and it shall be included and incorporated into our record. Okay. Is there anybody else who wants to testify about this application? Is there anybody on this side of the room who wants to testify? I see no one. Is there anyone on this side of the room who wants to testify? Mr. Fire Marshal, could you please do us a favor and check in the overflow room and see if there's anybody in there who wants to testify?
Scott said no.
Okay. So, let me look at my notes. So, the evidentiary hearing is closed. We don't have to take a vote on that. We just announced that it is closed. So, there shall be no more evidence taken. So, now we we will consider the facts at hand and have a discussion. So what I understand is that the hardship is that there are 45-foot structure setbacks from the travelway center line, and they're asking for a minimum 35-foot for lots 1 through 7 to avoid the septic drain fields. So that's hardship number one. And then hardship number two is the 100-foot road frontage on the travelway. They've met it for 3 of the 13 lots, and that prevents something creating land clearing and detrimental impact to the neighbors and natural resources. So, Mr. Albright, are we allowed to ask them questions, or is that it?
We are.
Deliberate on the evidence that they presented. If they have stated sufficient hardship and ability not to use their property unless you grant this, then the board deliberates. If they've met that by substantial, competent, material evidence, as you've seen, then you vote in favor. If not, then you vote to deny.
And we have to make some findings of fact.
Yes.
And I'm prepared to do that. I've been making a lot of notes up here with finding facts in mind. So, does anybody have any deliberation?
Well, I had a question, but we aren't allowed to ask questions. I thought we were.
What's your question?
Well, I had, first one was, is the road to be gravel or paved? Gravel.
We're not allowed to ask that. I don't think we're allowed to ask them. Their job is to present the testimony. Mm-hmm. And whatever they presented,
it's not
we have to make our decision based on the testimony.
Okay.
Mr. Carter, I don't believe that was an issue with the planning board. It wasn't presented by Ms. Cottle.
And it's not part of the ordinance. The So the issue at hand is whether or not, so they have not met the manufactured home park ordinance. There are parts of it that they have not been able to
fulfill.
And so we have to take a look at the ordinance, and they have presented that their hardships are the 45-foot structure setbacks,
right, mm-hmm,
and the 100-foot road frontage.
Right.
And so we can, if we find practical difficulties or unnecessary hardships existing with a strict application, then individual requirements may be modified, provided they are consistent with the spirit, purpose, and the intent of the ordinance, substantial justice, and the public health and welfare secured.
Well, so, I guess from a discussion perspective, the reason I asked that question is the topography. And you have apparent issues with erosion And if you've got a gravel road and you have a erosion, then there's perhaps a problem for emergency management equipment getting back all the way to the back of the property. And that's why I raised that issue, just a curiosity.
Right. Let's maybe I'll kick it off by making some suggestive findings of fact just to start with, okay? Here would be sort of some proposed draft findings of fact. Would it make sense for me to present these findings of fact and then we vote on each one?
Yes, if you can get agreement with the other board members that they have substantial competent material evidence supporting those facts.
Okay. So the applicants are the owners of that parcel of land located at 3147 North Carolina 54 in Hall River, North Carolina, zip code 27258, in a project they have entitled Cranmore Meadows. That would be finding of fact number one. Is there anybody, I guess, who would dispute that?
I wrote that down. That's where it's at?
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
Even their county map shows that.
The project is 13 tiny houses on wheels with all hookups.
And that's the max.
So we agree that that is right. That's a fact.
That's a fact.
The applicants have filed a request seeking a modification of the manufactured home park ordinance because of the 45-foot structure setback from the travelway center line. They say a hardship number one, and hardship number two is the 100-foot road frontage on the travelway that is met for three of the 13 lots.
That's a fact.
So that is, does everybody agree that that is a fact?
That's right, and our stuff right here.
There is drive, the ingress and egress meets the fire and other standards such as emergency services. The drive, quoting the testimony of the planning director, the drive is good. That's what she testified.
That's a fact.
That's a fact. The community well and septic, as proposed, are adequate. That's a fact.
That's part of the planning director's report.
That's gone through the health department.
There is a floodplain and an existing pond, as well as we had testimony that the property is bordered by a major creek, the Hall Creek.
According to this map, that's a fact.
That's a fact. And there are moderately erodible steep slopes.
According to the topo, that's a fact.
We have testimony that there are existing mobile home parks in the general vicinity of the project.
I saw those today.
Yeah.
That's a fact.
We have testimony that the applicants have proposed modifications, done things to keep the units apart and protect the public safety.
According that's to the planning fact. Board, that's a fact.
And we have testimony that there are moderately erodible steep slopes. Do y'all remember any other things that we should find as facts?
I think it's been covered.
So, the based on those facts that we have found, have we, so, is it done in form of a motion, Clyde, or is it just?
It's done as an approval based on the findings of fact that the board just discussed. You can approve or deny the request to modify the requirements of the zoning, the manufactured home park ordinance.
So we don't really take a vote on it either, right?
Was there anybody who doesn't feel like the, based on the facts and the testimony, is there anybody who feels like the request should not be granted?
No.
Well, you know, I don't like being hamstrung with what I can ask, number one.
It's just an evidentiary hearing. This is just
I've been, no offense, I've been here 24 years. It's the first time I've ever seen anything like this.
Think a lot of this is...
Not like this. And I have a rhetorical question, a hypothetical. I don't think the aesthetics of the unit should warrant approval or disapproval. I don't know the square footage of the units. I don't know who's selling the units. I don't know whether there's permanent foundations. I don't know whether there's tie downs. I don't know whether there's a lot of things that you would require in a mobile home, so-called mobile home manufactured housing park. Now, my question is, and I can't imagine that this can't be answered or allowed. If you have a person that want to do a mobile home park with the same number of units, would they have to meet could they get by with these guidelines, or would they have to meet the other established guidelines?
I think the answer to that is that they have to go by the mobile home park ordinance.
Right.
These people are asking for an exception to the mobile home park ordinance because of the topography and the special characteristics of the piece of land.
These are little bitty homes.
I know exactly what they are as far as, but again, you're looking at aesthetics versus factual, in my opinion. And, there's just so much I don't know. And I can't vote for anything that seems so vague to me.
Yeah.
I guess the reason that it's vague is because, like, the aesthetics of it or the size of the structure itself isn't relevant to the question of whether or not they have demonstrated their hardships and deserve the exception under the ordinance. So we did have testimony. I don't remember. Do we find as a fact that the minimum lot size is 8,000 square feet?
Yes, it's on the drawing.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's on the drawing.
And there's a minimum square footage size too, or I believe there was.
And yeah. I don't think we did find these facts. So the ordinance is met in these aspects, that they've met the 20-foot travelway with the 50-foot clearway. The minimum lot size is 8,000 square feet, which is adequate for community septic and well. There are two parking spaces for each unit, and there is some road frontage, which I guess is not really meeting the ordinance, that it doesn't have enough road frontage. But the ordinance has been met in those respects.
Well, and these are RVs. They're not typically mobile. You can pull them out of there and take them someplace, so they're not typically tied down or put in place on a foundation. They're on wheels.
Yeah, we did have testimony that they're still on wheels.
So it's a single wide mobile home.
Mm-hmm. A really small mobile home.
You can give them 800 square feet, 1,200 square feet, 1,400 square feet. And they got axles underneath them. We're splitting some fine hairs here, and I just can't be a part of it. I'm sorry. No offense to anybody there, but matter of fact, I wouldn't mind living in something like that at the beach, but I'm by myself.
I think in their document here it says the one they have built is about 250 square feet. Mm-hmm. I could probably pull that behind my pickup truck with that.
I think it's a great location for this particular RV park. And I rode down there and drove around as far as I could go, And it looks like to me that it's ideal for words where they want to locate it. I'll make a motion. We approve.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, so would it be the board's conclusion that all the facts we talked about are found, that there would be a hardship resulting from the strict application of the manufactured home park ordinance, that the hardship results from conditions that are peculiar to the property itself, that the hardship does not result from actions taken by the applicant, that the requested variance of a minimum of 35 feet for lots 1-7 to avoid the septic drain fields, and a variance or a relief from the 100-foot road frontage on the travelway for the 10 of the 13 lots that is not met, that those modifications are consistent with the spirit, purpose, and intent of the ordinance, such that public safety is secured and substantial justice is achieved in granting the application.
I'm in agreement.
Does this, do we have to be unanimous in
no.
Approving the modifications?
No. You have read that there's a complying with the ordinance would be impossible because of the contour of the property, the pond, the floodplain, and I made a few notes while you're speaking, resulting in practical difficulties and hardships and meeting the strict letter of the ordinance. So what they're asking you to do is to modify the ordinance, as you have stated, to let these smaller, tiny homes be put in there. And you have also concluded that this protects public health, safety, environmental, and fire marshals looked at it, the health department's looked at it, planning board has looked at it and recommended it. That's
and
all
this is an issue-specific modification to the ordinance, right?
And there's been public notice of this too, right?
Yes.
And so the public understands that the reason that we're being so careful tonight is because there is the possibility of judicial review. And so we are working very hard tonight to create a record that somebody else can come along and understand what we saw, the testimony presented, what were the facts, and what was the decision, and why did we make that decision, so that a judge, if needed, could review that.
That's correct.
Point of question. You threw out the figure 200 square feet. Is that the maximum?
250.
Well, 250. Is that the maximum?
No, that just happens to be the size of the one they built.
Okay. What's the maximum?
What we're looking at is our home similar to ours.
Or what's the biggest that you can put out there?
The biggest axle that we've looked at is 24 feet by 8 feet wide.
Okay.
So these are tiny houses on wheels that trucks pull.
What square foot is that? The
300 square feet.
Probably less than that.
Yeah.
24
Well, I would just I'd reiterate from my perspective that it's important that the public safety, the public health and welfare is secured because it's adequate for the septic and the well, and the fire and emergency vehicles can get in and out, and the ordinance has been substantially met in the other ways. Yeah.
And I think the fire and safety is a big aspect, and you guys have met that.
And it does appear to be consistent with the spirit, purpose, and intent of the ordinance and substantial justice. So we have a motion and a second to approve the application. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
No.
So, for the record, Commissioner Carter, Commissioner Lashley, aye. Chair Gailey, and Commissioner Boswell have voted aye, and Commissioner Sutton has voted no.
Okay.
So the application, I believe, is approved.
Thank you. We invite you all to come out there if you want to come see it.
Thank you. I doubt you'll be able to see it from the road just from looking at the
yeah, you got to drive down the road.
You can't see anything.
Yeah. Thank
you. Okay, thank you. Good luck.
Thanks. Thanks for coming.
I look forward to seeing it. It sounds very interesting. Would y'all like to take a recess?
Sounds like a good idea.
All right, let's take a 10-minute recess. And then we'll go back on the rock floor. All right, if we could reconvene, please.
I'll let everybody know. Love to go see you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
If we could come to order and reconvene, please. We had amended our agenda at the beginning of the meeting to discuss the rock quarry at this time. I think that the board had some questions based on Stephanie Thurman's public comments at the last meeting. And then tonight, she had raised some questions, similar ones. So what is going on at the state with the proposed rock quarry for Snow Camp?
Well, I prepared a brief summary of what happened with the leakage in Huntersville. I think I sent it all to you a few days ago, about the report from Colonial Pipeline and Charlotte Emergency Management and the response. That was the August 14th leak that they found two four-wheelers riding down the pipeline right away and gasoline bubbling up out of the ground. So they responded, the Huntersville Fire Department responded, Department of DEQ, North Carolina responded, and the pipeline folks from Washington also arrived. They sunk, they shut the valve off. They rerouted it through their, they have a second pipeline running beside this first one. So they shut it off, they sent a crew out, put 35 wells in the ground, started pumping gasoline out of the ground. And that is still continuing. They went 2,000 feet from the site of the leakage and put test wells. And they found to this date, no further contamination at those test wells. And they did make an offer to connect people up to city water if they wanted it. I don't think anyone accepted their offer. But an interesting note, the pipeline's been around 62 years, I think. This is the second leak at the same spot.
Was it a leak or surface?
It was a leak. The pipe cracked. They put a sleeve over it. And I think it was 1996. All of this is in the reports that I attached and sent to you. And the same sleeve, the sleeve cracked again. So I don't know if it's a problem with the soil or the maybe part of the earthquake we had earlier this year. I just don't know what caused it to crack again in the same spot. But they've sealed it and they've taken action to contain the gasoline. But 63 years being in the ground, I think that's the second time they've had a leak. There's also a rock quarry in Greensboro, right next to the tank farm, and the Colonial Pipeline runs right beside it, and it's also across the street from the airport. Mm-hmm. I don't think they've had any leaks or problems at that quarry. I spoke with a pipeline company's attorney, and he indicated they had completed a detailed plan with Colonial Pipeline, and they had filed it with the State Mining Commission, and they were awaiting results. He said they have been requesting additional information for about a year now on these type of issues. They want to be sure that everything's in place, and he said that's the status of it. And I spoke with him today, and he said that's still the status. They have not heard from the Mining Commission as to whether the permit has been approved or if it's even close to being approved. But they have given them everything that they had been requested to give them regarding pipeline safety. So.
When do they blast in Greensboro? I'm over there practically every day. I'm right in that neighborhood. I've never heard of a blast.
There's a huge quarry there. And
when do they blast?
They blast, I believe, they have scheduled times to blast. I don't think they do it at night, but it's not a massive amount like you see out in strip mines in Utah, where you see enormous clouds of dirt flying up in there. It's not that kind of blasting. It's a controlled substance. They put a goo that looks like toothpaste in the ground. They don't put sticks of dynamite down there with a wire. None of that stuff. They pump it in there and they set it off. And it's not a massive explosion because it's expensive to use explosives. So they control it as best they can. That's what I know about it, just from talking to the folks.
Well, I think Ms. Thurman had a valid question on the water issue. I mean, it sounded like Huntsville, they had opportunity to possibly hook on. To my knowledge, the only water is Southern High School, I guess, be the closest to Snow Camp. That's pretty expensive run of pipe.
Right.
Should something happen. And I think that's really what she's asking. What contingency plan does the county have to help out with that?
I think it would be Colonial Pipeline's issue to solve. And they may drill a community well and pipe the water from that community well. They would be the ones, and DEQ would be the ones that would lay that out.
So it would be their responsibility.
Yes, it would.
Does the county have any authority to require, suppose the county came up with a contingency plan. Will we have any authority to require either Colonial Pipeline or the Rock Quarry Company to implement the contingency plan that we came up with?
The jurisdiction over pipelines is the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. The water quality issues are covered by North Carolina DEQ, and the mining issues are covered by the NC Department of Mining, the Mining Commission. So I don't think the county has any jurisdiction over any of those things. That's not something we would normally get involved in.
Well, weren't they more concerned with the loss of water from the use of from the mining work than the contamination of the water? I think that was their concern. What happens if they lose a large volume of water and their wells start running dry?
Well, I think that was covered by their. Now, this has been a year ago, but we discussed this with the mining company. But they said most of that water that you're talking about is rainwater.
Right.
That they have to pump out of the mine. But because it's a giant piece of rock, it's not going to impact somebody's well because they're drilling through rock. There's no water in the rock. And the water they're pumping out comes from rainwater. That's the way it's explained to me.
I think it was an unfortunate use of terms when they talked about 550,000 gallons being pumped out, but everybody thought that was water running in from aquifers. And as you said, they've said that
surface water, I think, is what it is.
Rainwater runoff.
Well, we have these, excuse me, we have these county residents who are concerned about the quality of their water supply. And they've come to the county government asking for us to find a way to protect the quality of their water supply. So, why can't we do that?
I don't think we have the authority to do that. The state has to give us authority to do things like that, and they have maintained that through their water quality division. If a person puts 300 homes next to your property and your well goes dry, because they're also on wells, which happens, and been my experience that I have to call the well drill and he drills my well 60 feet deeper.
Yeah.
Had that happen before.
And that has happened. So the water table is what it is. And I don't think
what's under your ground is yours and what's under his is his.
Right. And we can't get into that. I don't think we have the authority to get into that as a county.
So you're saying that basically it all falls back on Colonial Pipeline and the Division of Water Quality should something happen.
Yes, and the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, they regulate pipelines and pipeline safety.
And the parties that would have a problem would be who?
Anyone that sustains damage from a leaking pipeline would be the party to have a claim. But that pipeline's been around 63 years. And I don't believe it's ever had a problem in Alamance County.
But so if they go in there blasting and it does have a problem, right. Then...
Well, the one in Huntersville just broke. It's not near a mine. It just cracked. For the second time. So.
What about her statement about the letters? I mean, was that new to you?
That's new to me. I don't know who wrote the letters or the substance of them. I do know from the pipeline attorney, he said they had provided a lot of information to the State Mining Commission. He's been working with the Colonial Pipeline folks on contingency plans and emergency plans and safety, all those type of things. They're concerned about it as well. Colonial is big business moving fuel through those two pipelines.
Is it Colonial only or is it Plantation involved? There's two pipelines.
It's Colonial is the ones I looked at.
And see, those pipelines go all the way up to New York Harbor.
Yes.
From the 40 Gulf inch, of Mexico.
40 inch, half or 3/4 inch steel, 40 inches in diameter. Mm-hmm. Two of them side by side. All the way up there.
Well, that's dissatisfying.
It just gets better, don't it?
I know.
Jesus Christ.
I would like to do something to be able to protect the water quality for the people who live in this county, the people who elected us and are counting on us to represent them. And I don't care if we're feeling like our hands are tied and then there's just nothing we can do. That just doesn't seem like...
Well, you know, maybe it's unsaid. You know, there's nothing we can do to protect, maybe now going forward, we think, but, you know, I think she's saying it's being said unsaid, if that makes any sense, for us not to make decisions at our level or planning that would overlook something that should have been heavily considered. Like, and you know, I've said it before, to have known that pipeline went through there, not under Tanya, but under the previous administration, leaves a lot to be desired, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And so I look forward to seeing what those letters are, if she's got them. She sounds very credible, so I would assume she knows what she's talking about with having the letters. I like to see them.
Well, I know what Swepsonville buys water from Graham. Other municipalities buy water from Burlington. I mean,
yeah,
got capacity in our water supply in the county, mm-hmm. not ours.
Right.
I guess the municipality of Snow Camp could buy water from another source, but then they'd have to put in the infrastructure. Well, that's true. Yeah, just. Well, they would have to become one in order to set a structure up like that, I guess. And then the infrastructure. And that's not where they want to go.
Ms. Thurman had asked the question if we could appoint someone or form a committee to look into forming a contingency plan for the water supply and try to determine what it costs might be.
Madam Chair, why don't what, may I suggest that we ask if that is something that has already been done? It may be that the aggregates company and Colonial Pipeline already have that. We just don't know about it. We haven't been a party to it.
What will we have to do to get that answer?
I'll make a phone call tomorrow to the mining company attorney and see if he will divulge that.
Well, that seems appropriate. And then shall we return to this topic at the next commissioner meeting and get an update? So okay. The public is informed. I understand you send the emails to the board, but then we want the public right. to...
Well, if the board desires, I'll ask him to appear if he's got such a contingency plan and explain it to the board.
Mm-hmm. We would love for him to appear.
All right. I'll make that request at our next meeting.
Great. Good idea. Is there any more discussion about that item?
Nope.
All right, if not, we'll move on to the Justice Advisory Council appointments. I serve with Adrian Day as the co-chair to the Justice Advisory Council. So we have a few people who put in applications, and so we have to choose between them. Do you want to talk about that?
Sure. We have four vacancies because the fifth one was on the consent agenda. So for the defense attorney, we had two applications. And do you want me to give the name of those, both of them, or just the recommendation?
Well, I think that the board has the applications mm-hmm. before them, so maybe the recommendation.
Okay. And so for that vacancy, we are recommending James Hunt Johnson.
And if we could pause, and the recommendations come from the executive committee for the advisory council, mm-hmm. Justice Advisory Council, not from the full council.
That's right.
So I'm sorry, I interrupted. Go ahead.
That's okay. The defense attorney recommendation is James Hunt Johnson. And so for the faith-based organization representative, the recommendation is the Reverend Dr. Larry Covington. And for that position, we had three applicants. For the consumer with...
Can we pause for that one? And let me inform the board. Phil Bowers has been serving in that slot for a year or two now. And we, the executive committee discussed that there's another sort of avenue for Phil Bowers to participate in the JAC. So we felt like if Dr. Covington were the representative from the faith-based organization, then we would ask Phil Bowers to serve in a different capacity. And then we could have both of them, and that would be very positive.
Yes, that's correct. And the third vacancy is the consumer with lived mental health experience, and we are recommending Art Springer. He is currently serving in that capacity as well. And our fourth vacancy is domestic violence victim slash a survivor slash advocate. And our recommendation is Dr. LaTanya Penny, who is also serving in that role currently. And beside each are the terms for each position. There are three with 3-year terms and then two with 2-year terms. And this is something that Tori was able to help us with on how to figure it out so all five weren't rotating off at the same time. Any questions regarding any of this?
Motion to approve.
Second.
So that's a motion to approve the recommendations of the executive committee. So Commissioner Carter has made a motion to approve the appointments to the Justice Advisory Council as recommended by the Justice Advisory Council Executive Committee. And Commissioner Boswell has seconded it. Is there any discussion about that? Before we take a vote, I'd just like to thank all the people who applied. Mm-hmm. And it was very difficult when we met to talk about those appointments. Mm-hmm. And we really appreciate the people who are willing to, you know, offer themselves mm-hmm. to service of the county. And the if somebody wasn't chosen, it's not a reflection on that person.
Absolutely.
And these were difficult choices. Mm-hmm. So.
We've got some good people.
Mm-hmm. It is. It's an impressive list mm-hmm. of community leaders.
It really is.
And
it
was fortunate to have them be willing to serve.
It was hard to choose between these people. Mm-hmm. So we really appreciate that. And we hope that they'll keep their applications active and look for other places where they could serve as well. Mm-hmm. So we have a motion and a second. If there's no more discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right.
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Haygood, do you have a presentation?
I do. Good evening, commissioners. Very pleased to be with you this evening and to have be in great company with Mr. Frank Bell and Brad Moore of our Soil and Water Division. We're going to talk to you a little bit tonight about our Voluntary Agricultural District Program and a new facet. We'd like to ask you to give us a blessing to move forward with adding to this program. So Mr. Bell and Brad are here. I'm sure that if they see something or something pops in your mind as I start going through this information, I'm counting on y'all to jump in and help me explain what we're thinking about to the commissioners as we talk about the future of the Voluntary Ag District program. So, don't seem to be able to move forward. Can you move me forward?
Yeah.
All right. So, just a quick overview of the existing program. It's very successful. I'm sure we're all familiar with the efforts of the county through Soil and Water and our Voluntary Ag District Board put together to preserve farmland. We have an ordinance from 2001 where the Voluntary Ag District was formed, and there's currently over 18,000 acres enrolled in the Voluntary Ag Districts. This is a program where farmers opt to put their land into this program, so it's recognized as agricultural property. It's a voluntary program, though. And then in 2006, an ordinance was passed to allow the county to preserve farmland in a little bit more of a permanent way, where development rights could be purchased by the county, and we allocate funding on an annual basis to help make this happen. And then Brad's folks work very hard to leverage those funds with the state of North Carolina. So currently we have over 580 acres that have been permanently protected via the purchase of development rights. So we have a successful, vibrant, voluntary ag district program in place right now. And I think what we've talked about as a group is how do you take that to the next level? How do you prepare for the future and take the voluntary ag program to the next level? So what we've talked about as a group with Frank and Brad, and I know Clyde's been involved in these discussions too, as has the chair, is about taking donations of land and property from willing owners. The voluntary ag program, the key is voluntary, right? So farmers have to be willing to put their program, put their property in the voluntary ag program, or willing to sell their purchase of development rights. We feel like there are farmers out there with property of various kinds that they might be willing to donate, either land or equipment, or even cash donations. We've talked a lot about people out there in the community who believe that preserving farmland is important. They might be willing to, particularly at the end of the year, make some type of a donation to the county that would go into the fund to be used to preserve farmland in Alamance County. We've also talked about how do you help people think about that if they're planning for their estates of their own property or money they have in retirement, and the federal government starts requiring that you spend certain portions of it by year's end. And we've also talked about how we would use donated land. If a farmer wanted to donate property to the county, it's possible to use it particularly for timber. I think that's one of the main ways that we've talked about planting trees, harvesting those trees, and taking the dollars from those sales and turning it back into the voluntary ag program. So the whole point of this is to preserve the farming future of Alamance County. So as far as the next phase of the Voluntary Ag District Program, well, we've come up with a kind of a tentative title for this program called Preserve Alamance. And it would be the next phase of the Voluntary Ag District Program. The County Commissioners, the Soil and Water Conservation District Board, and the Voluntary Ag District Board would all be partners. And we would include Piedmont Land Conservancy in that partnership too. The Soil and Water currently works with Piedmont Land Conservancy to help us navigate the legal aspects of purchasing property rights, and we feel like they would be, and they have indicated that they would be interested in participating with this new facet where they would help us go through accepting donations of farmland. And the initial mission statement that we've come up with for this next phase of Voluntary Ag District program is to preserve the farmland and sustain the farming tradition of Alamance County. We've come up with some goals. I'm not going to read all these goals to you, but do know that all this that we've come up with is to try to help guide this future effort into how do we continue to make good strides in preserving farmland, acquiring farmland, as well as some future goals about how do you help young farmers or farmers that people that are interested in getting into the farming industry. How could the county take proceeds from this program and help make that happen, either through assisting with the acquisition of equipment or making various kinds of payments all through the Preserve Alamance revenues. So it's really about preserving farmland and also trying to preserve the tradition of farming in Alamance County. How would we do that? These goals kind of help lay that out. Next slide. So we've currently got a strategy in place where for the Preserve Alamance program, where right now, today, every year, we budget funds from county government to help go toward the acquisition of either farmland development rights, or it could also go for the acquisition of property. This year, we budgeted $75,000. That's down from our normal allocation. I think the year before, we had done $150,000. Mm-hmm. COVID this year, we had a lot of reductions. But this is an action that helps this Preserve Alamance piece of voluntary ag program go forward. We do budget. Currently, we have $75,000 in this fiscal year's budget, and we also have almost $289,000 available right now being held in the county's coffers to be used as a match for state grant funds to buy additional property. And I think Brad was telling me before the meeting that you've about to start that process.
Yes, sir. We took applications in the month of September, and the VED board has selected its top two applicants to send to the state in December. And some of the funding we have to allocate to those projects. But again, it'll be roughly a year before we'll find out if they're in the program.
And we've had great success. They've worked very well with farmers that have been interested in doing this and have been successful in leveraging state funds. So that's in place now. We budget county dollars. Brad's group works with the Voluntary Ag District to leverage those funds to get more state money to buy development rights from farmers now. That's in place. We also have a piece in place that's the Voluntary Ag District Board. They have this grant program that Brad's talking about right now where they go out and look for farmers that are interested in doing this, and then submit those projects to the state of North Carolina and try to take the county dollars and get the state match to be able to buy these properties. And as I say, we currently have all over 580 acres in this program right now. So those two pieces are already in place. They're working. Next slide. This would be the new part that we're asking you to think about tonight and hopefully give us permission to move forward. We want to start allowing a way for farmers out in the county to be able to come to county government and donate cash if that's what they want to do, if they have an interest in doing that, whether that's cash that they have or somehow from their investments or as a part of their end of the year estate type planning, as well as farmland. If we have folks out there in the county, and Frank, anytime you got something I'm leaving out, you don't hesitate to jump in. But we have farmers out in the county that may not have heirs, that don't necessarily have people lined up to take over the farm, but they want the property to remain in farm use. And we'd like to be able to offer them the opportunity to come to the county government and talk about how they might would donate that property to the county to be left in farmland and leveraged for revenues or for use by people that are interested in getting into farming business. And also with equipment, we have folks out there, if they're getting out of the farming business, or they have no heirs and have equipment that might be useful, either for county government to use to try to raise revenues with this property that's been donated, or to possibly sell for cash that could be put back into the program. We'd like to be able to accept those kind of donations. And personal property too, you know, we've talked about cash and farmland and equipment. One type of property that we talked about in our small group is, even if somebody just has property, a home somewhere in the county that there are no heirs for and they would like to donate it to the county, it's not that we want that house or that lot somewhere in town. We would then sell that property if it was donated to the county under the auspices of Preserve Alamance, and the donor wants the cash to go to the preservation of farmland. That's the way we would manage it. Auction the property. Whatever it brings in goes into the coffers to add to that $288,000 to just keep trying to build those dollars up. We're currently not doing that. Right. We're asking for a mandate from the board, an agreement from the board, that we can start putting together a program to do that, that you're supportive of it as a board of commissioners. There would be some things that we would need to do in order to facilitate taking this new facet of voluntary ag program. We need to come up with a list of parameters about property, so we wouldn't just take any property, right? We want to make sure the property doesn't have any kind of hazardous chemical on it, almost like a phase one list. There would be a specific list of things to check off, that the property is acceptable and it's okay, and that voluntary ag group agrees it's good farmland. It's worth taking. It should be taken. We'd also want to be able to identify somebody, some group. PLC might be able to help us with this, but we also would want to, if the board's supportive of this action, we'd want to start talking to probably some estate planners and tax attorney type people about, would someone in that capacity be willing to serve as a liaison? So if someone comes to us and says, I would like to include the county's voluntary ag program in my estate planning, I'm certainly not qualified to make recommendations for people from a tax perspective. We need to find someone that could help an individual with that kind of that kind of guidance. We believe an on-call partnership with Piedmont Land Conservancy would help us do that. And then if the board supports this new facet, we'd want to work to put together a brochure and put together marketing materials to get the word out to the agricultural community in Alamance County, as well as people that just want to support farmland, that this is an avenue that you can take. You can come and sit down with county government and talk about how to do this. So the key is to get the approval from the Board of Commissioners to move forward with this new piece. So Bruce, if you get me to the next one. Okay. So we're currently using the first two strategies. We're budgeting funding, and Soil and Water works with the Voluntary Ag District to leverage those funds. What we're requesting is to work on that information I just gave you, where we're you're telling us it's okay with you if we start trying to market the fact that we will accept donations of property or equipment, or if you have cash, or if you want to set up something in your estate, that it would come to the farmland preservation efforts of Alamance County. If the Board of Commissioners is supportive of that, that's when we'll start working on these parameters about how to accept property, what to look for in properties when they're brought to us. And I think one key thing to take away tonight, if you vote to give us permission to move forward with this, if we have a piece of property that someone wants to donate to the county, we would be coming back in here with that information and say, okay, Brian Haygood has a 100-acre plot out here that he wants to donate to Alamance County. It has been reviewed by the Voluntary Ag District and the Soil and Water. It's been found to be a good piece of farmland. We believe we could plant it in timber and harvest it and put the money back. You would have to vote to accept that kind of a transaction. So,
would that go into a trust, or would it? How would we take title to that property?
Well, the county can take title to the property if it's donated to Alamance County. That it would just be a title change over to Alamance County. What's that?
So the county would then be in the farming business?
The county would own the property. Then if depends on what Voluntary Ag told us. If the Voluntary Ag group said the best thing to do with that property is plant it in pines and timber it, then we would find somebody to plant, just like we do with the landfill. Right. With the landfill property, I think Clyde is familiar with that.
Yes, we do that, and Richard can attest to this too. We have trees planted on our property there, and we sold, 2 years ago, $300,000 harvested that.
Okay. So we wouldn't want to be in the business of going out and like, you know, It may be that Voluntary Ag and Soil and Water say the best thing to do with this piece of property is use it for hay production. Then we would put it out for bid. If we had, does anybody want to come raise hay on this piece of property that the county owns, get the best bid in? All the proceeds right. that came from that would go back into Voluntary Ag.
Okay.
It would also be a combination of the landowner's wishes. It's very wide open, as you can understand. They may say, upon my death, with my 100-acre farm, cut out my house and 2 acres, give that money to the church.
Yes.
The other part of the farm, I'm going to give it to the county. My wishes are to keep it as a farm as long as you can, so rent it to farmers or young farmers or beginning farmers. If that's not profitable or doable, they may say, I'm willing, y'all can put it in timber. Or they may say, sell it to another farmer, and I want y'all to keep that money to buy the farmland. So there's just a lot of options, a lot of variables, so to speak.
And when we brought that donation to you to approve, we would have that information put together. So if we had a piece of property that someone wanted to donate, we would bring it to the Board of Commissioners to consider and hopefully approve, and we would tell you, this is what the donor wants to do. This much goes here, this much goes there. We determine that the best use of the property is a portion of it be farmed for hay, a portion of it be planted in timber, and maybe there's a farmer out there interested in getting into the business, and we're going to let them use a portion of it for something that the farmer wants to do too.
So we could in fact sell that land to somebody who wanted to go into farming business, I guess, right?
Yes, sir.
And then put that money back into the program.
And there's, go ahead, Brian.
Go ahead.
That land would have a conservation easement on it that made sure no matter who owned it, the county, right. If it's sold to another farmer, no matter who owns it, it will have to be a farm forever.
Yeah.
Maybe you want to talk a little bit about the Buster Sykes farm as a comparison and sort of a jumping off point for a discussion.
That's a great point. The Buster Sykes property, originally that owner came to Alamance County and wanted to try to figure out a way to donate that property to the county for farm use and farm education use, and it did not work out. I think we'd had a program like this in place at the time when Buster Sykes came, it would have been able to have been donated to the county and been owned by the county and managed that way too. It was not, and it's worked out well because it went through NC State, so the owner's wishes were met, but we feel like that's a great example of the owner has some specific things. They wanted it to be used as a teaching farm. So it's being used now by Cooperative Extension as a teaching farm, but it's also being farmed for timber. That money is going back to NC State, whereas if we have this program in place, we might use a portion of a new piece of property for the teaching farm, but anything is planted in timber, the proceeds would be going back into the Voluntary Ag program to be used somewhere else, either to buy some more land for conserved farmland or possibly buy equipment or whatever else was determined to be a need.
Well, there's one other portion of that we discussed in committee. There is a possibility in what you people need to, if you've got a better solution, let us take it to committee and thrash it out and come back with a better plan. What I'm fixing to say is there's a possibility, and we've discussed this, that we form or have a board of trustees that handles this, which would, in my recommendation, would have to be a person from that board in different aspects or different people of authority that can give us, it could be some of the people like a CPA that we're going to have as retainer to give us advice. It could be that with a person from the VAD board, the Voluntary Ag board. So what that is a possibility if you people are more comfortable with that, then we can initiate. We in a work in progress, so to speak.
That's right. That's very true. I think the desire tonight is to hear from the commissioners that you agree this is a good idea. It's a reasonable next step. I mean, I think one thing we've heard through the land development plan process, I think Tanya's already left, But the information I've read from the drafts is there's a huge interest in continuing to preserve farmland in Alamance County. And as I say, right now, Voluntary Ag and Soil and Water are doing a great job. I think this would, after we talked about this so much, I think this would add another tool in the toolbox, being able to take these donations and then market the fact that we take those donations. I think that's a good idea. And the details, indeed, would need to be worked out as we go along. But the key would be, we need your blessing and approval to move forward, knowing that anytime we're going to take a donation of a piece of property, if nothing else, we're going to be coming back in here saying, there's a piece of property that wants to be donated. It has been examined. It's been found to not have any concerns on the property, and there's a plan for the property too. I think that would be the key.
I like the idea of a trust. I think that's a good idea. Mm-hmm.
So, Frank or Brad, is there anything I've left out?
I would say this. As you know, I've sold all my life, and I've pitched this to a lot of people. I've pitched it to professional people, doctors, different people, and we have got a good review from everybody that we've exposed it to.
I think it's a great idea.
I think the Voluntary Ag District Board found it to be acceptable at their meeting. They were in favor of adding this to the toolbox.
Farmland is important. They're not thinking anymore.
That's very true, and I think I think this will be, you know, our goal here, and Frank has said this, is to use this new facet of this program to help create some revenue that it's difficult for us to do through county budget all the time or to the levels we'd like to be able to do. So if we're able to receive the donations of cash from folks or put it out there as an option for their end of year planning for what they have to do with their funding based on federal tax law, or that if they've got a piece of property over here somewhere in Burlington that they own but don't want and don't feel like it's worth, you know, too much money or whatever, making that donation for us to auction with all the proceeds, even if it's $5,000-$6,000, that's a help for this for this program.
Straight into that.
That's right.
That's matching funds, basically.
That's correct. Yeah. They have shown a huge success in being able to take what small amount we're able to give through the county budget and leverage it into significant state funds. So the hope would be, if you approve this new facet, it would do the same thing.
I make a motion to approve it.
Second.
So Commissioner Carter has made a motion to approve, and Commissioner Lashley has seconded it. Is there any more discussion?
It's just a great idea.
I think we're all in agreement. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
Let me just thank Frank and Brad. Thank y'all very much. It's been fun working on it with y'all, and I look forward to continuing to work on it. So thank you.
Thank you, Frank. All right, Alex Rimmer, our interim health director, has a COVID-19 update for us.
Good evening, commissioners. So our data will be shared in a little bit different format now. So we have a COVID dashboard, thanks to our IT folks. So we'll start with today's case count. So as of today, this updates every day at 1 o'clock. We have 30 new cases, 4,930 cumulative cases so far in Alamance County. 4,449 have been released from isolation. We have 408 active cases. 28 of those 408 are receiving hospital care. Sadly, there's been 73 deaths. We have 747 close contacts being monitored. So those are the folks that were close contacts of the active cases. And we've released 8,631 close contacts as of today. In the month of October, we've had 12 total deaths in our community. 9 of those have come from long-term care facilities and 3 from general population. So I know these case counts are much, much higher than we've seen in the past, especially with the having over 400 active cases. We've remained under 300 for quite some time, around 250 for the most part. And so just in the past 7 days, we've had 348 new cases. and approximately 65% of those cases are from general population. So a pretty large, significant amount of those are just from general population. So the other 35% are from long-term care facilities. We currently have three outbreaks in long-term care facilities. The largest one we've seen to date in Alamance is at Alamance Healthcare. So we are doing weekly testing there now, twice a week. And we're doing that to provide them with testing from the health department so that we can help them contain the outbreak. And we've seen a decrease in cases since we've done that. So unfortunately, in total, this outbreak began in early August. There's been 104 residents that have tested positive, 52 staff, and 5 deaths. So we are working with them, and we talk to them daily. We've involved the state with that as well to try to get any mitigation strategies and support that they can give us. Peak Resources has identified an outbreak, so that we identified that last Tuesday. And it started with two staff members. So the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare require surveillance testing in the community, and it depends on our percent positivity. And so what that does is it allows them to test staff to ensure that staff aren't bringing it in the facility so that they can then isolate those staff members. And so one resident was positive and two staff at that point in time. And so they've had a total of 42 residents, 18 staff, and 3 deaths, sadly. So what ended up happening is when we identified that outbreak, because there was a resident that was positive, we recommended that they go ahead and test everyone so they could cohort folks and have them separated if they were positive or close contacts. And so they are doing their own testing, and we're having daily communication with them. And then Twin Lakes also has an outbreak with 6 residents and 11 staff. So all of this gets updated to the state on the COVID dashboard at NCDHHS every Tuesday and Friday. So this would be the same information that would be found there. And Elon's dashboard as of today, the last time I looked at it had 38 active cases, and they updated it 4, so the numbers may be a little bit different. So when you take a look at the new dashboard, you can see the daily case count. If you hover over the date, you can see the number of cases for that day. So that's a little bit different than how we displayed it before. So it gives you a pretty good idea of where we're standing, and you can see the history from the first case till now. So we'll scroll down and look at the zip code map. And so we got to use Esri, one of our programs in the county, to be able to do this to show a heat map. And so the darker the color, the more cases in that zip code. And so the zip codes do go outside the county lines, but it's important to note that the cases that are shown on this website are in the confines of Alamance. So if you looked at Mebane, for instance, which goes into Orange and part of Caswell, if you click on it, you can see the number of cases. So that's not for all of 27302, it's just for the Alamance County portion of that. So that's the total number of cases we've seen in Mebane thus far. So just a different way to look at data. You can still click on everything and see the number of cases. It's a little bit different than the percentages we were showing before. It's a little more real-time data. So this is the number that everybody's really interested in, right? So our percent positivity. So if you take a look back, at the end of August, we were up at 9.1. So we had reached a peak that was around one of the phase changes and restrictions being lifted. And then we went down for quite some time, 6.1, 5.1, 5.7, 4.9, and then 5.2. So we stayed in around the 5% range for quite some time. And then as of October 10th, we are at 7.7%. So we've seen a rise in cases in the community, as you can see with our numbers. As a result, mostly of phase 3 and some of the outbreaks that we're seeing within the community. So this number does get updated. So it appears to be a week behind, but it just allows for the time for the testing results from all the different places that do testing in the community to be reported to NCDHHS. And then they take out any number. So if someone had been a positive previously and tested positive again, they would take that number out to not skew the data. So that's our weekly testing numbers.
These graphs are a little bit different. So you can see on the left bar graph part in purple, so that's going to be the cases versus county population. So you can see we've seen all along that 20 to 39 age range has been a high majority of the cases. And then you can also see on the right side, 80 and up has increased quite a bit. And so that's going to be because of the long-term care facility outbreaks we've seen. And this is our cumulative case breakdown by race. And again, you can see cases versus county population. Pretty similar to our county population. We continue to try to get into historically marginalized populations and try to provide testing and making sure that testing is available to all the areas of our county. And then we'll scroll down. And so this shows ethnicity. And so it shows, as we've seen before, the Latinx population had quite an increase of cases near the beginning of COVID. And so we did a lot of testing in the Hall River area and things like that. And this is indicative of some of the cases we've seen. So, and we've tried to provide testing targeted around where we see disparities for race and ethnicity to make sure that everyone has access to testing. So we're still working on getting death stratified to have that information as well, like we had previously in the weekly demographic report. So that's something that'll be getting added here soon. And so the increase in cases is really calls for us to continue to do the 3 W's. And reinforce that. And so I know Amy and I were on a call last week, and that was a lot of what they were talking about was mask wearing and talking about how we can get that message out to the community. So we're really trying to focus on trying to widespread outreach everybody in the community.
Still no cases in the jail, right?
No.
Excellent.
Tell us more about that. That was, so one of those big spikes that we had earlier, if you scroll back to like that really tall one, was that related to the jail outbreak?
Yes, it was.
And so what, so a lot of new precautions were taken at the jail,
mm-hmm.
especially with testing people more, mm-hmm. and everybody who gets brought to the jail is tested, is that right? And then isolated until their test comes back?
They are, yes.
And then what happens? What other things are going on at jail?
So when an inmate or detainee is brought in, they're tested, and they're actually quarantining them for the full 14 days. But they are doing that test when that happens. They're also screening inmates, and so if they become symptomatic, they're separating them out and having them tested, and then also quarantining their close contacts, which is really important so that if someone does end up positive with COVID within the jail, they're separated very quickly.
And how long has it been since there was a positive case in the jail?
So they had to go through, just like a long-term care would have to go through or any congregate living facility, a 28-day cycle with no positive cases. So I don't have the exact, let's see, that spike would have been on 9-1. And if I remember correctly, October 14th was the day that the outbreak was declared over. So they went that whole 28-day cycle until October 14th without a case.
And has there been a case since October 14th?
So I think they may have identified some positive cases coming into the jail, but thankfully because they were quarantining, they weren't introduced into the rest of the population.
Wouldn't it be a little unusual, though, to go from 99 straight down to zero? I mean, that.
So there was a few weeks where we did have more positive tests, and I don't have, because the jail outbreak isn't really the top one going on right now and is over, I don't have that in front of me, but if I remember correctly, we had the 99, and then there was maybe 2 weeks of 14, if I remember correctly, and then at that point we went down to zero. So part of the reasons that we were able to minimize the spread so quickly with the help with the sheriff's department is they were really great at cohorting folks. And so if they were positive or they were a close contact, they were able to utilize those cell blocks in order to separate people. And they did that with staff as well and addressed staffing and kept certain staff with different areas.
Good enough.
think I'm going to let her go without asking something?
No, we don't. We know you don't.
We were just waiting for you, Tim.
Maybe only one more meeting I'll be asking her questions. But what's the phrase you're using, positivity?
So it's the positivity rate. So what that is it's the number of tests that were done in the week, which we can see on there. So if you hover over there, so 3,928 tests were done, and 7.7 is the positivity rate.
And that's the ones that are confirmed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, again, I hate to always talk about the quick in and out, but you confirm them, and 90% of them are basically, it appears, quarantined and let go, it appears, the numbers-wise. I mean, I'm not going to pin you down on the percentage, but if you've got like 5,000 that you've confirmed and 4,500 has, you know, been quarantined, let go, and you got 500 active cases, again, the positivity is just of those that are confirmed. I think the most important, in my opinion, going on a national look at this statistically, would be the number of people that require medication of some sort, or it's more serious.
Hospitalization. Hospitalization.
Yeah, or not necessarily go to the hospital, but, you know, to have 5,000 go in, and then in 2 weeks, basically, theoretically, down the scale somehow, 4,500 of them go out. That means you got 90-some percent of the public in our county, for instance, that don't get it, that it appears to me. And if you've got, like, I think I was looking at 20 per 1,000 were being confirmed in our county, 20 per 1,000. And now I think it's up to 30, if I'm not mistaken, you know, based on the numbers I looked at today. But the statistics on this and how we're looking at them, I think, not you, but, you know, how the CDC is doing it, how, you know, the national look is, I think it's, maybe we're looking at the wrong stat as far as the seriousness. But let me ask you this, on another topic. Did you ever work with Dr. Van, who's with mm-hmm. Guilford County Schools? I heard her, I listened to their school board meeting in part, and she was being asked questions about the testing that, you know, a lot of people had reservations about going in for the test due to the uncomfortable. And she made reference to a easier test now, and you may have alluded to that in the past, but can you comment on that at all?
Yeah, so Dr. Van is their health director in Guilford County,
right.
And so there's a couple different types of tests that they do. There's the nasopharyngeal, which is the one a lot of people talk about that is so high up in the
right.
nasal passage,
yeah.
And is quite uncomfortable from what I've been told. There's also nasal testing that's done, where it's more in your nasal passage, very similar to a flu test that you would have done. They also have mouth swabs that they can do. I don't know how accurate they are. So obviously, like we've talked about before, PCR tests, which are a molecular level, they're a lot more preferred. As far as accuracy, and so they're kind of the gold standard of a lab test, and so that would be considered the nasal testing or the nasopharyngeal.
Yeah, she was referring to nasal. She didn't mm-hmm. say anything about mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's not bad. I had that done. It's not painful at all, and you know within a day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the test results are turning around very quickly right now in the majority of the mm-hmm. labs. So.
Well, with the community spread, what do we need to say to the community about the viruses in the community and it is spreading? We have a higher percent positivity rate. I think that there are people who say that it should be below 5 for the schools to be open. Is that right?
So the World Health Organization early on spoke on what percent positivity that it would be ideal for schools to open, and it was 5%. The CDC has not come forward and put a number out there because it's really hard to target, and every community is very different. And so from public health standpoint, and when we have conversations with ABSS, our biggest thing is taking the information that NCDHHS has given us and trying to provide guidance on what decisions they make. And so when looking at going back to school, taking those precautions like wearing masks and social distancing as much as possible and lots of hand washing, those are the kind of messages that we're reinforcing and talking about. If someone is positive or symptomatic, what the next steps are and what to do to protect the kids in the school and the staff.
I saw an article in the New York Times this morning about reopening the New York City schools and that testing the children and the staff, doing random testing, was a big part of their approach. Do you know if in North, and maybe I should know the answer to this, but in North Carolina, I don't believe I've heard a lot of discussion about testing the children coming back to school as a way, because, I mean, we can see at the jail, I guess, how public health can really work wonders in a contained, sealed environment where you can really move the people around and know everything about them. Mm-hmm. So obviously with the school system, you don't have that. You have people coming in and out. You don't have that rigidity available. But you can see through the jail's experience that it works. The testing and isolation and tracing and isolation, it works to stop infectious disease. So what's been the discussion about using the testing in the public school system to assist with reopening?
So they have talked about that and use it on the college level with universities and things like that to do surveillance testing. Elon, for instance, does surveillance testing weekly of certain, they try to target different areas where there may be positive cases. And so the one thing that is really complicated with trying to think of this is first cost, because it's very cost prohibitive to do this testing constantly. Another thing is if you test them before they go back, that's only one point in time. And like you say, you don't ever know who these children or their families would be exposed to or what kind of activities they do or where they may go. Everyone's very different. So at the jail, they're contained to a cell block or cell, and you can contain that outside exposure, whereas kids, they're going to activities, they're going to soccer practice and all kinds of things, or you know, within the community. And so it gives you one point in time, but as we've seen with COVID, that incubation period is a little over 5 days. And so ideally, if you were going to be tested, you get tested on day 6 or after. And so there would still be some folks that were indeed positive with COVID that wouldn't show up positive in those screenings. So some school systems, like in New York, what they're doing is they're using that as kind of like a supplemental tool on top of the mask wearing and social distancing as just an added layer of protection. So at this point in time, NCDHHS hasn't talked about that, but a lot of the guidance they're doing is trying to do the precautions that are less costly and take less people to be able to do, just because of the massive amount of children that we have in our school systems.
Was it maybe an example of letting the perfect get in the way of the good? I mean, it would be perfect to have the money to test everybody and get immediate results back and do that, but isn't it good to do random testing and it helps, right?
It helps to separate out people that would be asymptomatic, which is really important, because if those folks can then be in isolation, then they wouldn't be spreading it to all of their close contacts.
It would be correct to assume, I guess, that 7% is 7% of people who felt they were symptomatic to get and got tested.
So there's some different reasons someone would get tested. So some people get tested because they're symptomatic. Some are required if they're traveling or if they're about to have a procedure. So any COVID test that's performed in Alamance County would be encompassed in those numbers.
I'm going to say something. I know that will be very politically correct, but who cares? Until we all show up at the same dogfight with the same dogs, this is just going to keep going on. The health organizations, World Health, WHO versus CDC, two different organizations. The politics of both are extremely different. Their philosophies are extremely different. In my opinion, some health organizations don't care whether the schools go back or not.
Not to that, there's the election.
Yeah. They don't care about the bar, the restaurant owner. the businesses that are going down the tubes. We're all in different dogfights, turf wars, and turf protection. And, you know, I think we've got a problem in this country, but how to handle it is not a team. It's almost like it's a turf war. And I hate to see that, because there's a lot of teenagers, there's a lot of businesses, there's a lot of people that are just flat suffering because somebody's making a decision that, well, you can't have but half your business open, or you can't go to school.
Sometimes the cure is worse than the disease.
Yeah, you know, and I think that's a big part of it. It's the politics of how we handle these things. And I think you're right. I think after the election, whatever, you're going to see a whole lot of improvement.
Everything will go away.
I'm sorry. That's the way I feel about it.
Well, we did have some good news in the economic summit we had this last week. Alamance County is leading the state in economic recovery.
Great.
68% economic recovery. So that's excellent news.
Do you have any more questions?
Thank you.
I think we need to move on. It's 9:41.
Yeah.
And
I was just getting wound up.
Still have some stuff. I need some of your energy. So
put a lid on this.
Kendria Rollins has a presentation about the ABSS lottery fund debt service application.
Good evening, commissioners.
Good
evening.
Good morning.
It is getting late. If you recall, we have a capital plan in place anticipating issuing bond debt for ABSS and ACC this year, and as part of that capital plan, we have an agreement with ABSS to use lottery funds as part of our payment for debt service. Before you is an application that we'd like to submit to DPI to draw down $1,459,068 as part of that plan to pay debt service this year. And we request approval from the board to do that. ABSS has already done this approval at their October meeting.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Thank you. Commissioner Carter has made a motion to approve, and Commissioner Boswell has seconded it. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Good job. All right. Mr. Haygood, you want to talk more about our revenue and recommended expenditures?
Certainly. Commissioners recall that at the last Board of Commissioners meeting, presented information about how the revenues are doing for this fiscal year and made a recommendation of three budgeted actions that I felt like the commissioners could consider taking. The commissioners tabled that item until this evening. So I'm not going to run back through the same presentation that I did for you. I do have it here. I'm happy to answer any specific questions from it. Just a summary for you, if you'll recall, at the time I went over our four largest revenues, which make up about 95% of our entire revenue stream. These included property tax, which I reported is coming in on target, as we have projected. Our sales tax proceeds thus far are far above what we projected. If you recall, that was our biggest hit to the budget this year, was a 20% decline from 1920 dollar amounts, and we are significantly above those dollar amounts at this time. Our intergovernmental revenue is slightly down, but we feel that that is going to recover, and our sales and service revenue is down, and we believe it is down because of COVID related causes. Again, you'll recall it does feel to me a little early to make this kind of to make these kind of recommendations based on just 3 months worth of revenue, but primarily because our sales tax revenue is coming in so well and property tax is coming in the way that we expect, I felt comfortable at the time recommending compensation package for the sheriff's office and detention, as well as the health nurses, and also to give funds budgeted from the sales tax articles to ABSS. All three of these are in the current budget. They are currently in the approved fiscal year 2021 budget. We had been waiting for the sales tax revenues to pull the trigger. So the health director, Alex, is here, and sheriff is here. If you would like to hear information about particularly the raises
and the compensation piece for the sheriff's office detention and the health nurses. I'm sure they could speak to that. So if you have any questions for me, I'm happy to answer them. I still feel comfortable recommending this to the board. I think these three actions could be taken, even though it is early in the fiscal year. And the reason why is our health nurses have worked extremely hard and have traditionally been difficult to recruit and retain anyway before COVID. So it seems like it's important to continue to keep them engaged and keep the crew that we have here with us. And then you've heard from the sheriff's department about their struggles. It's a competitive market for good police officers, good deputies, and good detention officers. So before COVID, we wanted to try to stay competitive in several arenas. Those were two of the big ones. So I believe it's still a good move, even though it is early. But I do understand the commissioner's concern about making this kind of decision at this point during the fiscal year. So I don't know, Sheriff, if you want to say anything about why it's important to your folks.
I'll tell you. Main reason important to our folks is we're having people retiring, talking about putting them retiring. I told you last time we lost over 200 some years of experience, people retiring because they didn't see no better retirement coming because of no raises. Also, we have a problem. We're working our people extremely hard. I'm very proud of our people. They're going to do it regardless of what you do. But these individuals deserve compensation. We said right out there, they worked all day today, day out there tonight.
Mm-hmm.
I've been told we've got about four more that's looking at retirement or retiring after the first of the year, which will be about another 200 years of experience gone by Alamance County Sheriff's Office. And today is extremely hard because of what's going on in our nation and the way the protest and the police are being treated to attract good, viable candidates. And if you can't do that and you have to lower your standards, you're going to have lawsuits and everything else coming that's going to cost you a whole lot more in these races.
Well,
I appreciate anything you can do.
Well, you've got the money in your budget this
yes,
time.
Yes, sir. So money's there. They were positions frozen. That money's there.
Yeah.
That's correct.
The issues with serving on the health department board, I'm talking about what they are dealing with over there.
They work hard, too.
They do, and I know they're putting in. I was told that I believe it was May, they had already hit over 160 hours in comp time.
Yeah.
Now, we can buy that comp time, but that's a whole other issue. But she can't find contract nurses at $32 an hour. That means if we can't even hire people to help support us through this mess, and we're only getting an increase in caseload. So, I think we've got to do something, guys.
So, Alex, I don't know if you want to also speak to, I want to make sure you get an opportunity to speak about the nurses.
Yeah, so the nursing salary increase is a tiered approach, and so it's from 4.5 to 9%, and it's incredibly important, more so even now with COVID, that we keep our 230 plus years of experience that we have as public health nurses in our health department to be able to retain and recruit nurses as well. I mean, we're struggling recruiting nurses to come in and help with case investigations from part-time to full-time. Many of our nurses work 60 to 80 hours a week, and they have been for over 7 months. A lot of these employees are exempt employees, so it's not like a non-exempt employee that would get comp time for this. As an exempt employee, you know that sometimes you work longer hours, but after 7 months, that's a really long time to ask that of somebody. And the supplemental vacation leave of 160 hours for most of them ran out in May. So they're working because of their love for the community, their love for public health, and keeping us all safe. So. Just to speak to that, I mean, public health nurses do far more than the average primary care nurse. When you come into our clinic, not only do they do clinical services, but they mm-hmm. help you get to resources you need. So children right. that come in for immunizations, they point them in the right direction. If there's housing issues or if they need help applying for Medicaid or things like that. Helping moms with family planning and maternity care. I mean, it's a very rounded circle, and we also are part of the communicable disease response, and so things from hepatitis A in jails to mumps that were, you know, the outbreak at Elon. Foodborne illness that happens at restaurants or at our family's cookout. Like, we're, that is where public health nurses come into play. So they touch every aspect of life. And so I think it's really important that that's noted when thinking about this, because it's really important that we're able to retain these individuals and be able to fairly compensate them.
I think the one thing to remember is these funds are budgeted. The balanced budget included taking these actions. We have just not done it, waiting to see how the revenue would come in, particularly sales tax. Sales tax has come in well. Property tax is coming in on target. I am concerned about sales and services, but that is COVID related. If I remember correctly, it's our ambulance fees, it's our parks fees, mm-hmm. it's our passport fees. Those things are down because of COVID. They may stay down, but what we're seeing is our sales tax numbers are coming in very, very strong. It is early. That is absolutely true. These two particular areas, the sheriff's department and the health nurses, to me seem to be so critical that I'm willing to make that recommendation to you to fund this and take this action, even though it's early, based on this early revenue report. So on the screen you can see the proposed costs and how it will affect each organization. It's 92 folks over the sheriff's office. If it's effective October 1, it's a little over 167,000. It's 22 folks over at the health nurse shop, and it's almost $72,000 effective October 1st. And then I know there's a lot of discussion about the school system funding. These are articles that are sales tax cash that is for the school system. However, if the commissioners wanted to wait until December to make the decision about the school system, that can be done too. You can do any of these or none of these. I would certainly encourage you, for the nurses and the sheriffs, to give that consideration. The sheriff has frozen additional positions to make this happen. You know, we did not fund him. We funded him this year at a level where he had to freeze 11 positions. They chose to freeze anywhere from, I think it was 15 to 18, to try to make these dollars appear to take care of the rest of the folks. Health nurses was budget. So I believe it was actually budgeted to take effect January 1, but they have lapped salary. They are capable of making it happen October 1st. So, and again, as far as the schools go, I'm sure they would appreciate the funding, but if that's more than the commissioners feel comfortable with at this time, we could wait to address that later in the calendar year if that's what the board wanted to do.
I would like a motion that we pass the sheriff's raises and the health department.
I'll second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. I have a question. What about the coronavirus relief funds? Don't we have bonuses or hazard pay scheduled to be paid? And when is that, and how much is that?
So it was going to be, we had budgeted for a second round of coronavirus money. I think the total cost we would be able to use CRF funds for was around $875,000. It was going to give two tiers. That's what we did the last time. They got two tiers, anywhere from, I think, $750 bonus one time up to $1,500 bonuses, and it touched almost all of our emergency services. Last time, the Sheriff's Department paid that with their own funds from fiscal year 1920. We would be looking at doing it the second round of hazard pay bonuses with including the Sheriff's Office in the CRF money, so it wouldn't be any of his dollars. So I had looked at bringing that to the commissioners in November to present to you, to say if you're, it's very similar program, same groups, very similar tiers.
Well, I think both of these departments have done an extraordinary job in bad times. That's what we've had.
I'm fine. It's a good motion. I'm second. I mean, I'll third it. There is such a thing.
Well, I'm struggling because we've got bonuses and hazard pay on the horizon, and we have 5 months under the belt of sales tax. So I'm looking at the first 2 months we were in the red, and the next 3 months we're in the black. But, and Lord knows I love the sheriff and his officers and appreciate them, and you know, fighting the virus is a really big priority, and appreciate the nurses and the job that they do. So I'm really, really struggling with this, but my heart, I mean, I have to vote my conscience, and my heart is just telling me that 3 months in the black is not enough for me to feel comfortable.
It's going to be a good Christmas. I feel it coming.
Well, I hope so. I hope that you all are right.
If the federal government can get together with the Democrats and the Republicans and free that money up, things are going to go like a rocket.
I think that is an excellent point. I think if there's going to be another stimulus round, that will be helpful. And it is a difficult call to make this early. But if it weren't for the groups that we're talking about, I wouldn't even feel comfortable recommending it. But
they're deserving.
Well, especially, I think I would be more willing to entertain to vote for a motion that maybe was to fund the health departments because of the virus, and it is spreading, and they are, but the sheriff's department, they've gone through a mess as well.
Yep.
I just, my gut tells me that 3 months isn't long enough, and I feel like, I remember Mr. Haygood, you and I were talking a few months ago about the fiscal impact of 2008 on the county budget, and that the first year it went pretty well, and the second year after the recession started, it was worse. And I'm just really...
This ain't the same problem we had back then, I can tell you.
I don't know. I don't know if it is, or if it's better, if it's worse.
Well, as I understand it, the sheriff's office has the money in the budget that they haven't spent to use for the money that we're talking about here. So it's not like we're putting new money into it. This is money they have allocated already this year that hasn't been spent.
So. That's correct. So the sheriff's office received the budget. The budget that they received, 11 positions could not be filled, right? We met with the sheriff beforehand and said to balance this budget based on what we think we're going to see in sales tax, you're going to have to freeze the equivalent of 11 positions for us to balance the budget, which he agreed to do. But then the sheriff, so that means he was funded for all of his positions minus 11. The sheriff and his folks got back with us and said, we want to implement this proposed compensation plan. My take was, you have to do it with the dollars that you've got. There's not going to be any new money. You know, I don't even know if we're going to get the money that we're projecting, the 20% down. So the sheriff froze additional positions, as I say, anywhere from 5 to 7, maybe even more, I can't remember now, enough that he's covered this dollar amount with his existing budget. But what he did was freeze various positions and not hire. And he's going to have to do that for the rest of the year. They have identified positions where they've said, okay, we're not going to be able to hire these positions in order to do these raises. So he's operating within the approved dollar amount budget for the sheriff's department. And the way he's making it work for these raises is freezing positions on his own volition. He has done that himself. I have not. He didn't do that to balance the budget. He did that to get the raises.
And the total of the two is quarter of $8, right?
Mm. That's correct.
Yeah.
Did you say there was a similar thing at work with the health department?
With DSS, there is. DSS
with
is very...
the health department?
Yes, well, the health department, for the nurses, they were originally budgeted for their raise to start January 1. However, they've had enough lapsed salary in their department at this point that they could start their raises for these nurses October 1. So I felt like we've looked at their lapsed salary. They have enough money in their budget. We don't need to add any money to the health department's budget. They've already had enough openings to cover this raise for the rest of the year for the health nurses. And what I was saying about DSS has the same capacity. We froze 11 positions at DSS also, so they were not funded. They had to freeze 11 positions because there's no money there. But DSS has also had significant turnover, lots of open positions. You know, if we continue on a good trend with our revenues, I'll be back at the first of the year. We'll be talking with Adrian about, because she has some significant turnover problems. Also, can she do the same thing that the sheriff has done, freeze positions, identify lapsed salary, and try to make some specific targeted raises for the positions that turn over so much.
And as we went into the budget season, we went in on a conservative note. It wasn't like we said, we're just going to go in.
Yes, this was the most uncertain budget year I've dealt with, where, you know, the word we were getting from across the state was anywhere from 10 to 50% sales tax reduction. 20% was a number that we heard the most. You know, in a global pandemic, there's no real good way to estimate what the impact would be. We felt like a 20% decline estimate from 1920's numbers was very conservative. And we got a balanced budget with that revenue amount. These folks are working under that revenue amount. So these programs can happen currently with the current dollars that we're bringing in. Frankly, we were just wanting to make sure that we didn't go below the 20% decline. That was the main fear, was I didn't predict a bad enough sales tax number. But it right now, and it is early, it is absolutely early. We've only got 3 months worth of revenue that we know of for fiscal year 1920. That's the reason why I would only feel comfortable recommending these, knowing who these folks are, health nurses and sheriff's office, at this point.
Well, June was up almost 2.5 times what April was down, and about 4 times what...
Because of Christmas, the revenue is going to be coming in for these places like in Mabin.
Yes, you can see how we traditionally do, right? So the if you recall, that purple line is 1920. So when we get to the December, January, we usually see a pretty good uptick. The two blue bars, that's where our sales tax revenue is currently. We're above 1920, and that orange line is where I projected that we would be for 1920, based on what we thought might happen with the COVID shutdown. So
what I hear you saying is that you take the current budget of the Sheriff's Department and the Health Department, and you squeeze it. You're not adding to it. You squeeze in what you already have, and you're getting blood out of the turnip.
Yes. Yes.
Madam Chair, I think you got a motion.
I'm aware.
I didn't know if we were going to need to get our pills that
it
night
is
or what.
It is 10-1, too.
Yes, I'm aware. The time. This is a hard decision. You know, this is a struggle. Okay, Commissioner Boswell points out that he has made a motion and Mr. Lashley has seconded it. I assume there's no more discussion. So all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right. Thank you. All right.
I got
to use that as a vote. Let's roll. We have a budget amendment from the elections. Yes, we can.
Kathy's here. Oh, all right.
Hi, Kathy. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Can y'all hear me?
Yep.
We can.
Yes.
Hello.
Speaking of somebody has no sleep.
Really?
Last Thursday night, for sure.
I said, speaking of somebody who has no sleep.
True. Okay, what I'm bringing before you is a budget amendment for $58,500. It's part of the CARES Act supplemental funds. We were aware we would probably get the $10,000. The $48,500 is money that is $100 per person per election worker for election day. It's a hazard bonus, and every voter that works on election day. Please disregard that. Every worker that works on election day will get that bonus in addition to their regular salary.
Motion to approve.
Sure.
Second.
Okay. Commissioner Carter has made a motion to approve. Commissioner Boswell has made a second. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Good luck, Kathy.
Thank you, Kathy.
Thank you.
Yeah, good luck.
We got an NCDEQ COVID-19 recycling relief grant.
Richard, how you doing?
We're going to do this in a minute or two, okay? So, like everybody else, COVID's hit us. Our volumes went up about 40-45% this summer. That's mostly a reflection of everybody home, schools out, businesses out. On the coattails of that increase comes a lot more recycling that showed up. Sheer volume overwhelmed us as far as man hours. The market is in a horrible situation as far as trying to sell. So what's happened here is the Deeks group out of the NCDEQ group has some money that we pay into a fund. $2 of every 40 that we collect at the landfill goes directly to the state. We only get a very small portion of that money back. We're paying for their engineering, their administration. This is an opportunity to get some of that money back. We are transitioning to what we call single stream. All your recyclables minus glass go into a container. We crush it, compact it, send it to a MRF in Greensboro. It's a much more efficient process. It's much easier on our on the public, on our customers, because they don't have to self-source anything. They can put it all in one place. These dumpsters, these compactors go for about $24,000 to $27,000. This is an opportunity to get 20,000 of it back. We plan on buying three of them, whether we get this money or not, but just a good opportunity to offset the cost of one. Just need your okay to go forward with the application. It's due the end of this month. We've already got it filled out, just pending your okay.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Commissioner Boswell has made a motion to approve, and Commissioner Lashley has seconded it. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Let's see if any of these people have stuck around this long for the public comment. Bryant Crisp. The overflow room has frozen over. We can't get in it. Hopefully those people have not.
There are a couple people in that way.
You want to just bring them in here?
Yeah, let them come in here.
We got plenty of room.
I'm not sure what we want.
Yeah.
Hey, you can have a seat. Thank you. Is there anybody else coming?
Yeah, bring whoever's back there.
Yeah, anybody who's...
He's getting them.
Oh, okay. Does it? Oh, okay. So I'm going to go down the list to be fair. It looks like we only have one person, but I'm going to call the name since they signed up. Bryant Crisp. Is Bryant Crisp here? Bryant Crisp is not here. Karen Coble Albright. Is Karen Coble Albright here? She is not. Samuel Wilking. Is he here? He is not. Amy Jackson.
She has written comments.
Okay, great. Would you please read them? And we'll run the timer as well.
Okay. I have heard some say that we who seek the removal of the Confederate statue just don't understand history. So here's some history. Alexander Stevens, Vice President of the Confederacy, made clear in 1861 that the foundations of the Confederacy, its cornerstone, rested on the racist belief that the Negro is not equal to the white man, that slavery, subordination to the superior race, is his natural and normal condition. This is history, the history represented by the statue donated by the United Daughters of the Confederacy, can't talk tonight, to the city of Graham in 1914. And in case there was any doubt about its symbolism, Jacob A. Long, founder of the Graham chapter of the KKK, spoke at its dedication ceremony to remind all gathered that the statue stood to recognize the white race. This, too, is history. Jacob Long had in 1870, with 62 other white men, dragged Wyatt Outlaw, an African-American town councilman, from his home and hanged him to death from a tree right there in the Graham Courthouse Square. Shortly after, Klan members in Graham lynched William Perrier, and in 1920, just a few years after the statue was erected, John Jeffress, a black man accused of a crime against which he was never allowed to defend himself, was likely lynched by a mob in Graham. This is history, the history over which the Confederate statue stands guard. Now, I am a Southern white woman, and I understand the desire to remember my white Southern ancestors in a positive light. And though I am proud of much of my family history, I have also come to accept the uncomfortable reality that my family and I have benefited from the many generations of white supremacy and white affirmative action represented by that statute. My history does not make me powerless to change the future, though, nor does yours. You have already heard from many community members that their well-being and security are compromised by the presence of the statute, and NC Law 100-2.1 Section C3 gives you the power to remove a monument if it is a threat to public safety. You have also the power to petition the legislature to overturn or modify NC 100-2.1. The statue's removal will not erase our history, good or bad, nor will it guarantee that all of the county's residents will receive equal justice under the law as they deserve. But taking down the monument to a white supremacist version of history is the first step toward facing up to the past and creating a future together.
All right. Thank you for reading that. Next on the list is Faith Cook. Is Faith Cook here? All right, next on the list is Morris Wells. Did I say that right? Is it Morris? Maurice. I apologize.
You're fine, Miss Amy. How y'all doing today?
Good.
How about you?
My name is Maurice Wells. I'm a resident of Mebane. I don't want to give my address due to death threats, but I'm one of the main protesters out there protesting against that monument, and it has put my life, my family's life, in danger because of that monument and the white supremacy that it brings to this county. I know most of the people out there are not from here, but they've assaulted people, they've hurt people, they've threatened people, and it's really nasty and ugly. And I just want to let that be known, because I can't even bring my child here to this city without being threatened or assaulted. And I will continue to protest until that monument is gone and things will change in this county. And I just want to come here to tell you guys that it's hurtful that I have to fight this hard for something to keep me safe. And it's hurtful that I have to deal with this on a daily basis here in Alamance County. I still got time. I don't know how to tell you. I know y'all said that safety hazards, my life is in danger. Will it take someone dying behind this monument for it to be heard that it needs to be removed? Thank y'all for letting me talk. I'm not really good with talking. This is my first time coming up here, but I just wanted to let myself be known. Nice seeing you again, Miss Amy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. You did an excellent job.
I'm glad you came tonight. Okay. We do have one more person who has signed up, and that's Jamie Pollan. And it doesn't look like she's here. Okay, do we have commissioner responses? I can see Mr. Carter is thinking very hard, so I don't want to blow by without giving you the opportunity to organize your thoughts.
I just don't believe that this body, I've known these folks for a long time. I know there's a lot going on. We are struggling with a lot of the questions that you're talking about. I don't know anybody on this board that I would say I believe is a racist. But we've all been accused of that. And I hate what you've had to go through. I would be the last to want to see that perpetrated against anyone. I'm sorry for it. I'm sorry for you. And I know that I think this body opposes racism in any form, in any form. And thank you for coming to speak tonight.
Yeah, I'll echo that, and I'll say that, so I told you, I guess it was Friday, we ran into each other at the Elmira Community Center. I went there to vote, and you were there, and introduced yourself to me, and I was glad for that, and grateful for the opportunity to have a conversation with you. I reject white supremacy. I reject racism. Some of the things that I've heard being said and done around this county are shocking. And as I told you on Friday, you know, it's wrong that you've been in fear for your life, and it's wrong the way that you've been treated, because you're standing up for something that you believe in. And you're a part of Alamance County just as much as I am, as anybody, and you deserve to live in peace. So I regret the experiences that you've had to go through, because you're standing up for what you believe in. I think that's all I'm gonna say tonight. But I'm glad that you came. I'm glad that you got in. I did give your name and worked it out. So, all right, Mr. Hager, do you have a county manager report?
I do not.
Do we have any commissioner comments?
No.
We do have a closed session scheduled for tonight. At least one of the, we have some personnel things that are, I think the people that are affected by them really want us to hear what's up. So I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-, actually, I'm just gonna do the, can we skip the attorney-client privilege ones?
If the board wishes, I can prepare a short memo for each case that you wanted to talk about and email it to you.
Can we do that without messing up the agenda and we're not?
I think we can. I think if the board wishes to do that, just instruct me to do it and I'll prepare a memo, confidential attorney-client memo, and email it to each of you.
Let's do that.
Yep.
Is there a consensus for that?
Consensus.
And then, so I make a motion that we go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-311.11A6. In order to consider a confidential personnel matter.
Second.
All right. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Let's go in closed session.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Bell.
Before you adjourn, I want to make one statement. We were going to do it a moment ago. I like to say that four of you guys is leaping. Possibly four.
She's a guy.
I voted for her today, so she's
you did.
She's going to ride.
You made my day. Thank you, Mr. Sutton. I wasn't sure.
I did vote for one Democrat, though, and I ain't going to say who, but it wasn't a local position. And it wasn't governor either.
We're going to guess in close session.
I know it's late. I'm going to be brief. I've been involved in this process for the last 11 years. You've been on this board for a long time. So have you, and so have you, and you've been here a less time, but I just want to personally thank you. As a taxpayer and as a citizen of this county, thank you for your dedication and for your service to this community. And Steve, as I said to you earlier, you're going to be the only one here, so you need to be get your teaching skills
get ready
in order.
I think Frank just told you to get your act together.
I'm sitting over here thinking, shake up.
Thank you guys. I just want
you to made it an honor.
Thank
Frank.
You, Frank.
Thank you, Frank.
We've got a lot of good done.
And all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? The board considered confidential personnel matters. That's our statement. So all the business of the board being concluded will be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.